I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. Praise shall continually be in my mouth. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. Oh, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. Praise him, all ye nations. Praise him, all ye saints. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise him, all ye nations. Praise him, all ye saints. Praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Praise Him, all ye people. Praise Him, all ye nations. Praise Him, all ye saints. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. I praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Praise Him, all ye people. Praise Him, all ye nations. Praise Him, all the saints. Oh, praise the Lord. Let everything that has breath praise Him. Oh, let everything that has breath praise Him. Oh, let everything that has breath praise Him. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. We praise You, Lord. Praise You, Lord. We praise You, Lord. Praise Him, all ye people. Praise Him, all ye nations. Praise Him, all ye saints. Praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. All ye servants of the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. All ye servants of the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Are you servants of the Lord? With a shout. Oh, with praise. Oh, with joy. With prayer, with joy, oh, with singing. Oh, come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. All ye servants of the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. Come bless the Lord. All ye servants of the Lord. exalted, risen King, clothed in majesty, all your works they see, of the glory of your name, and praise you, they praise you, they praise you, they praise you, and we praise you, we praise you, singing Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King. 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 In honor and majesty, all before you, Lord, and strength and beauty are in your sanctuary. Oh, honor and majesty.
Hallelujah. Holy is the Lord, holy is the Lord our God, holy is the Lord, holy is the Lord. Precious is the blood of Jesus, the redeeming blood. Precious is the blood of Jesus, that cleanses me from my sins. And holy is the Lord, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord, holy is the Lord. And precious is the blood of Jesus. Precious is the blood, precious is the blood of Jesus, the Redeemer's blood. Precious is the blood of Jesus. Precious is the blood, precious is the blood of Jesus, the Redeemer's blood.
Just lift your voice towards heaven and let your voice be heard in just thanksgiving and praise unto the Almighty God. Let your requests be made known. He's the living God. He loves you. He's here to meet with you. Begin to lift your voice to Him right now. Begin to make your requests known to God. Father, who is over all things, who's higher than the highest, mightier than the mightiest, stronger than the strongest, He'll respond to you right now. Let the glory of heaven overwhelm you. Let the glory of heaven flood your soul. Come worship the Lord. Come worship the Lord. Come worship the Lord, Almighty God. Oh, come worship the Lord. Come worship the Lord. Come worship the Lord, the Almighty God. Oh, come worship the Lord. Come worship the Lord. Come worship the Lord, the Almighty God. Higher than the highest, greater than the greatest name, higher than the highest is the Lord our God. Higher than the highest, greater than the greatest name, higher than the highest is the mighty God. Come and worship the Lord. Worship the Lord, the Almighty God. Worship the Lord. Lift your voice to Him. Lift up your voice and sing. Make your request to the King. Lift your voice and worship Him, worship Him. Hallelujah. Holy is the Lord, hallelujah. Oh, we want you to go ahead and really worship Him. Too many people have been just listening to CDs. It's time that you learn to worship the living God, that you learn to lift up your voice and begin to praise Him and begin to exalt His holy name. If you're serious about God, God will be serious about you. If you ignore him, I guarantee you it's not going to work out. Just begin to praise him right now. Hallelujah. Begin to worship the Most High God, creator of the heaven and the earth, more powerful than the most powerful, mightier than the mightiest, stronger than the strongest, higher than the highest. Begin to worship him now. Begin to reach out towards heaven. And God will hear you, will answer you, he'll meet your need. He'll redeem your life. He will heal your body. Hallelujah. Higher than the highest. Higher than the highest is the Almighty God. Higher than the highest, greater than the greatest name. Higher than the highest is the Almighty God. Higher than the highest, greater than the greatest name. Higher than the highest is the name of Jesus. Is the name of Jesus Christ higher than the highest, greater than the greatest name, higher than the highest? Is the Almighty God. Hallelujah. Just lift your voice. Sabrabera masutaya rabebe kisotoyo. Higher than the highest, greater than the greatest name, higher than the highest is the Almighty God. That's right, just go ahead and praise it. God's people in his house ought not to have to be encouraged so much to glorify and magnify and be excited about his name. God's people ought not to be in such a state. God's people ought to be carried away in the realms of the Spirit, caught up in the realms of praise and worship, captivated by the realms of his glory. Ha ha. God's people that shines like a light brighter than the sun at noonday. God's people filled with his glory and his power. Hallelujah. Well, manje retango isere mandero monjesitaya ramonda. If you could just step out of the cares of this life and the deceitfulness of riches. Somebody says, I'm not rich, I'm just making a living. Once again, the deceitfulness of riches. Because what we call making a living is just nothing more than the deceitfulness of riches. And they can just step out of all the things that are temporal pleasures, pleasures that take away from you the glory of the treasure of heaven. Oh, you'd be so excited about God. I'd be having to try to get you to stop and settle down just for a moment because I'd like to talk to you. You're captivated and constrained by a worldly system. And God's going to give you the ability to completely break through. If I could get people to start fasting and praying, they would break through. If I could get people to go on a fast from religion for 6 months, there would be a breakthrough. And somebody said, how do I go on a fast from religion? You begin to engage in a relationship of walking in the Spirit and living by the Spirit in a way to where that you are in expectation in your life for God to be doing the things that he describes in his Bible, rather than living in a self-justified state, explaining away all that God said that we're supposed to do and be and how we're supposed to interact with him. Tongues, interpretation of tongues, prophecy, rivers of God's glory flowing out of us, not every once in a while, but a continual baptism of the Holy Ghost and fire, an encounter with the presence of the Lord that captivates and raptures your heart and carries you away into a realm that causes everything around you to be fully manifested for the evil, for the wickedness, for the otherness that it is from God. Oh, I pray in the name of Jesus that this day you will really truly allow God to settle your case in heaven, that you will no longer self-justify, you'll no longer live based upon your experience that has accommodated something far less than God has mandated, but you'll begin to say, okay, Lord, I'm going to come and I'm going to bow before your altar. I'm going to bow before your presence. Tonight we encourage all of you to come, because I believe with all of my heart that, Father, if you're willing to hear and you're willing to obey, a lot of people come and willing to hear. Do you know how many faithful people there are in the United States of America that are willing to come to church and hear? It is pretty impressive. Who knows? It may be actually, you know, somewhere near 30 million plus people that will come today in the United States of America, and they're willing to hear. But do you know how many people are willing to obey? It's really not very many. Here you are today in a small church. You could get carried away in God and you're constrained by your own opinion. You could get carried away with God and you're captivated by your own understanding of what it means to know Him. Whereas God, the Holy Spirit, wants to step into your life, and He wants to erase that, and He wants to so overwhelm you with His passions. He wants to so overwhelm you with His glory. He wants to so overwhelm you with His emotion that you begin to live out an existence that is not defined by any earthly thing. You begin to experience in your passions and your emotions that which only the life of God and what He describes as His glory so overwhelming us as a river, as rivers busting out of you. What's happened is too many people for too long have created an ideology and a philosophy of what that means. They have negated the scripture by popular tradition and opinion, by following after models that don't look anything like Jesus, that don't look anything like the seraphim even worshiping around the throne, who with two wings they fly, and two wings they cover their face, and two wings they cover their feet, and they cry with great ecstasy and passion as they behold something of the Father's glory that is the inspiration to do what they do. God wants to cause you to see, but what blinds you is your cares of this life, your deceitfulness of riches, the pleasures of this world, your own way, your own choices, your own interpretation. You know, listen, the Bible is not for any private interpretation. Everybody wants to interpret the Bible according to what they think, and according to what they believe, and according to what their denomination teaches, and according to what the models around them would describe. But did you know that there is a place to get along with God and His Word, and He, the Holy Spirit, would begin to show you what it looks like in a heavenly realm? He'd begin to open up your eyes so that you can see visions. You can see, in other words, clearly into the realms of that which where Father dwells. God would open up your eyes and give you dreams and revelation concerning who He is and what kind of an abundant life He really gave us when He gave us His life. A life that is described as eternal life, but it's when it's said in that way, people have just made it something that happens after you die and go to heaven. You are, after you die, what you are while you are now alive. Is there anybody who can interact? That's about what that sounded like. Is there anybody who can interact with God? He's here. Oh, this is terrible, isn't it? Trying to find the button, but you can't find it, huh? Trying to activate that switch of the spiritual, but it just isn't readily available, is it? You are what you are. And you can't pretend in the presence of God. You are what you are, and you can't play make-believe. One day, you're going to stand before the Almighty, and everything is going to be revealed about your life. He's going to read it out. And you can say whatever you want to say about how you love him and about how you think he's so wonderful and about how good he is. But Father's not going to alter his word. He's not going to alter the life that he made available to us when Jesus poured out his blood at Calvary's cross. He's not going to say, oh yeah, your alternative life, which was not the life that I described in your Bible, is it's okay, it's acceptable to me. No, he's not going to do that. There's one life to be conformed to. There's one life that we're allowed to live, a life that Christ Jesus poured out, lived for us, poured out for us, imparted to us, that the Holy Spirit's come, baptized us, and here to lead us and guide us. Thank you for one thank you, Father. Thank you. Praise God for one thank you. I'm going to be happy about one thank you this morning because I realize the deadness of the Church of America. I realize that even in the best places, people are only doing just so much. There's so much compromise going on in the lives of God's people. Tonight, we're going to show you some things. Tonight, God's going to show you some things in the Spirit that if you're willing to hear and to obey, everything about your life will change instantly. If you're not willing to obey, you're here, people come, they're here, they see the miracles, they see the signs and wonders, and they delight in it. And oh, this is wonderful. And oh, I'm just so glad somebody got a hold of God, knows the Lord, and so happy that somebody is really taking God up on his opportunity to live out this glorious life, this supernatural life, this realm of divine power and faith. But they don't obey. They're never willing to pay the price. They're never willing to pay the cost. They're never willing to go all the way with God. They always just want to self-justify and hope that everybody else around them will sympathize. I pray that that from man you will cease and that God you will pursue. Hallelujah. You can be seated. So I want to give you some instruction. I want you to understand that you were supposed to have woke up this morning and danced around and praised the Lord until you got happy in God. Not till you got pretend happy in God. You know, pretend happy in God is ha ha, he he, you know, just trying to work up a smile. I'm talking about getting overwhelmed, baptized in the realms of divine power and glory. Because then your life is going to change. Then you can begin to say that you're led by the Spirit. Then you can begin to say that your life, your emotions, your passions, your thoughts, your attitudes are governed by God the Holy Ghost. Otherwise, it's just going to be governed by you, and you're going to look like you, and you're going to act like you, and you're going to say, you know, with all the other religious people, you know, all the things that religious people say when there is no true display of the power and the glory of God. So somewhere in your life, you're going to, you know, basically what you do every day is because you were taught to do that, and unfortunately, you were taught to do that by man, and you are a good little person in the citizenship of humanity. And you get up and you go to work and you're just so faithful with mammon and you're just so faithful to live out those things that you were taught from, you know, preschool and maybe even before that. And oh my, acceptable to humanity extraordinaire, while all the time you're not participating in this wonderful life that God has made and given to us. Or maybe just a fractional participation. Just a fractional. A fractional participation and then a full confession. A fractional participation with a full confession. I've been born again. I've been baptized in the Holy Ghost, baptized in the fire of his presence, and walking in the Spirit. While all the time, that never really happened. Or it happened once 20 years ago, or it happened once, you know, last month. Or it happened just occasionally, I get excited about God. What is that? Occasionally I got excited. You just respond a little bit to the wind of the Holy Ghost. Because Father will come and feel you. Somebody says, well, I don't feel it. God will come and fill you with his feelings. He will come and fill you with his passions. He will come and fill you with his glory. He will come fill you with his life. But he's not going to force it on you. He's not going to make you. You have to be willing to say, I'm going to come out from among them. I'm going to be separate. And it's not some kind of religious separation. It's, oh, God, I'm not going to participate with all the things that of hate and all the things of lust and all the things of the pride of life and all the things that men hold dear and all the things that mammon dictates. People have no idea how much mammon dictates to them every day. Your money interest, your bill interest, how it consumes you. Somebody said, well, aren't we so supposed to be responsible? Not in that way. You're supposed to be responsible to God first. And if you were responsible to God first, oh my goodness, you would be blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. I mean, you would prosper and be in health because your soul prosperity is so enormous in God, because you're seeking first His kingdom and loving His righteousness and one and being a person who so wants to fully be able to respond and to Him and enjoy the benefits of what Calvary purchased.
Yes, yes, Lord.
Praise God. One yes, yes, Lord. One grunt over here. A little bit of a strain back there. Everybody else is sitting there. Why? Because this realm called the Holy Ghost is not activated in your life. You didn't get up and dance around and praise God and worship Him and begin to worship Him in spirit and truth until the Spirit of the Lord baptized you in fire. You got baptized in fire how many years ago? And how long did it last? What was it, 45 minutes? An hour and 45 minutes. A day, 24 hours, maybe a week. And then something happened. No, God wants you to be filled continually with the Holy Ghost. He wants you to be continually baptized in the fire. If you're not baptized in His fire, it's an evening and a morning offering. You know, I had a Jewish guy yesterday or the other day asking me, he said, you know, really, shouldn't we be keeping worship on the Sabbath? I said, you should be keeping the worship every single day. You know, the religious, go, amen, you know, praise God, hallelujah. But the reality of it is people aren't doing it. In the model of the New Testament, we understand that Sunday is the Lord's Day. It's the day that Jesus rose from the dead. It's the day that He made His appearing. It's the day that Paul referred to as gathering those things that men had to bless the Lord with, His saints had to bless Him with, so that there'd be no gathering when He came, as He said to the church at Corinth. But you must understand something. That was all in the context of them having church every day, in the morning and the evening. After the model of the morning and the evening sacrifice. Ain't nobody hard. There's very few of us that do that. There are very few of us. Everybody else is busy. You're busy with your mammon. You're busy trying to get yourself a promotion, get people to like you. You get out on the street. You say those things in the grocery store and in the coffee shops that you go to and wherever else that you visit, that hopefully people like you. You don't want to be the oddball. You don't want to be the crazy guy on the block. You don't want to be the village idiot. You're always trying to impress folks around you. Father wants to take you out of that human consciousness and that seeking after the praises of men. I'm going to show you something tonight. I just want to seed you with it a little bit. When I was in Zambia, they were telling me about a church that was 3 kilometers by 3 kilometers. Not 10,000 square foot, not 30,000 square foot, 3 kilometers by 3 kilometers. I posted it on Facebook today if you saw it. And these guys, and you'll look out and you'll see hundreds of thousands of people in the church. I think on that particular day they had 38 children born in the meeting. They gave the how many girls, how many boys? I mean, you got hundreds of thousands of people standing there. Why? Because when people fasted and prayed till they bled, basically. They stepped out of the realm of the world into the realms of heaven. People being raised from the dead all the time. Every sign and wonder and miracles that you can think of is happening. And you know, all you're going to see is you're going to see hundreds of thousands of people baptized in the fire. And you know, when I see that and when I hear about that, you know what I want to do? I'm going to go and join them. I'm just going to live there and join them. I can do anything. Somebody said, well, how are you going to make a living? That's not even coming into the equation. How are you going to eat? Didn't even think about that. Oh, you didn't see? You're not thinking clearly. Oh, no. Think very clearly. No, I just decided I'm pursuing the things of the kingdom. Unfortunately, the Lord won't allow me to do that because I got to be a plowman in the Western Greco-Roman world. In a culture that is so anti-Christ and anti-God. that is so consumed with mammon and human interest and the pursuit of what we individually believe, so that someday, possibly, we could have again the shakings that took place in the past that brought a great wind of the Spirit and a great moving of God. He would say, oh, in the day of His power, His people will be willing. Oh, no. You don't understand. That is true, but there has to be somebody who's going to pay the price, who's going to pursue those things which God insists to have. Father is not going to delight in people who are all excited, cheering their heads off, screaming their heads off over something that came right out of the worship of Zeus that we call football and baseball today. And then they get to church and they're just standing there. Their emotions and their passions are wrapped up in their finances and their wealth. Oh, if the stock market's going the wrong way, they can feel it in their bowels, in their guts. But how about lost souls? How about the hunger and the passion for the flow of divine power and the encounters with the Spirit of the Lord? It's the blank stares. It's the inability to connect. It's like talking about trees to people who live above the 80th parallel, because there are no trees there. And if you've never left, the tundra, you don't even know what trees are. You describe the difference between the oak leaves and the pine needles. I could start giving you some molecular biology facts right now, and you would look pretty much the same. We could talk to you about some basic things in physics and chemistry, and basically same response. No ability to connect. But when it comes to the realms of the Holy Ghost, it should excite you. As soon as any moving of God happens, there's something, there's a witness, deep calling on the deep. There is a realm of hookup, a divine connection, where you will be able to see and understand things that men have never experienced. Where God says, I want to, and this is what He does. What I'll give to you what eye has never seen. I'll cause you to hear what ear has never heard. I'll cause you to understand what has never entered the heart of men. But it ain't happening. It isn't happening. Because when you begin to do that, you begin to interact on a level that Elisha's servant interacted with him, where all of a sudden he moves to a whole nother realm and dimension of faith and a dimension of partnership with God, because suddenly he sees that the whole atmosphere that all surrounding him in the world around him was the angel of the Lord and the horsemen thereof. Before, he thought it was just two of them against a whole nation. Suddenly he gets revelation because he has an encounter. His eyes begin to see what eyes have not seen. His ears begin to hear what ears not heard. His heart begins to understand what has never entered in the heart of men. He begins to get a glimpse of reality. And reality and eternity are equivalent. That which is unseen right now can only be realized by you and me through the operation of the Holy Ghost. Somebody's going to have to get real. Tonight I'm going to show you some things and talk to you about some things that are a result of a few people getting real with God. They said, no. I demand of myself what God has commanded in His Word. I demand it. I demand to see evidence that I have a river, that I have rivers of God's expression. I demand to see the evidence that I have a wellspring. I demand to see the evidence in my life where there is visions, where there are dreams, where there is the reality, something that is quantitative, something that is provable, something that is not make-believe, it's not fictional, it's not the imaginations of religion and men's ideas to try to explain away what God has said. This is the evidence, this is the proofs that you belong to me, that you're born of me, that I am with you, that I am in you. And what happens, that in itself, and that commitment in itself tears you away from lust and iniquity and cooperation with the world and its power and its evil and its minions and its dominions. People do not want to hear the voice of people like me preach, because I will confront your unwillingness to walk with God in the state of you justifying yourself and saying you are right. But this is revivalist talk. This is where God raises up men and women who to cry out that there be anybody who would hear their voice, that God could have a company of people. I'm going to tell you right now, if someone's standing up in a park and they're jumping around and they're hollering, doing wild and weird things, all somebody's going to say is somebody needs to lock that guy up. If somebody starts following the person doing crazy, wild, and weird things, it becomes interesting for a moment. If then all of a sudden 10 people are carried away, 20, 100, 2,000, 5,000, everybody starts running. Instead of wanting to lock them up, they want to join them. Hello? Doesn't really go on in the context of the kingdom, not in the context of the Spirit, because men have no ability to comprehend, no ability to connect, because it's a whole nother realm. It's a whole nother realm. Only God, by his miracle power, can come and change your heart and your spirit so that you can connect. But then it's still up to you. Are you willing to really truly obey God? Because he's going to tell you, you can't have what I have for you and said that you could have until you're willing to walk away from the stuff that I told you was wrong and evil. Till you're willing to come under the authority, till you're willing to come under the power and the sovereign reign of the Holy Ghost. That's where every people start backing up. That's where we start justifying, self-justifying, because we're not confronting him face to face right now. And we start self-justifying. We're looking around for people to basically validate our wrong state and our wrong position. Validate me. Somebody validate me. I'm going to go to a pastor and get him to validate that my evil is okay, that my unwillingness to walk with God with all my heart is okay. And so many leaders and so many teachers and ministers, unfortunately, tell people what they want to hear because it's an itching ear spirituality. I'm going to tell them what they want to hear because I want them to come back. I want them to like me. I'm going to tell them what they want to hear because they really need to go to work, because that's how the church is going to raise funds. And all the other self-serving mammon that goes on. People, Christ Jesus is coming very, very soon for you. There's some of you in here, you will not be alive in 10 years from now. There's some in you in here, you will not be alive 20 years from now. Some of you in here, you won't be alive 30 years from now. Even if some of you in here will still be alive 80 years from now, still, it is such a short span of time. But there's some people in here that won't be alive, perhaps maybe even next year. Jesus is coming for you. Eternity, I should say, really is coming for you. Because you're going to have to be willing to come into this life of Christ and die in Christ if Jesus is coming for you. Because he's not going to justify any kind of a state of life that is other than the life that he gave. The life that he gave is described by the life of God from Genesis chapter 1, verse 1 to Revelation 22, 21. It is inescapable. It is absolutely in every way inexcusable for man to live any other kind of life when God has done so much for us to have this life. He by himself redeemed us. He by himself empowered us. He by himself has come to love us, to mentor us. But he stands, as it were, almost in the shadows of our life because of our ignoring him and our pursuing our own way and justifying that mammon can be my God and I am all right. Because my culture dictates to me financial success is the most important thing. God said it's the most evil thing. My culture demands of me greatness, to be bigger and better and more sharper and brighter and more full of pride and arrogance and self-will and self-sufficiency, when God says the opposite is true. See, what we've got to have is we've got to have people in the United States of America that will have enough encounter with God to be willing to pursue him. Enough encounter with God to believe that he really is, that he really exists, and that they will have and lay hold upon this life. And as soon as that happens in your life, suddenly God is free to speak, and the floodlights start shining across your soul, God says, that can't be in your life, 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 that, and the list goes on. And then we immediately go, but so-and-so has it, and so on, and we begin to argue with God. But why shouldn't I have this? Because after all, how am I going to eat? How am I going to sleep? Wherewithal am I going to be clothed? Jesus already answered those questions. God will never argue with you. You're going to have to step into a far greater dimension of cooperation with him before he's ever going to have a conversation like he had with Abraham with you. Oh, God, excuse me for a minute, but if there are 50 righteous, would you save the city? He's not arguing with God, but he's actually petitioning him. People argue, well, it should be okay for me to live my life the way that I'm living it, for me to have a dual existence, to dichotomize my life, to be bipolar, to have multiple personalities. Nonsense. Anybody that told you that there is a dichotomy of your life is a devil personified. That you can be one thing in business and one thing in whatever at home. I have an opinion at home and I have a public opinion. I have a business opinion and I have a church opinion. I have opinion at play and I have opinion at work. You're bipolar. Multiple personality. Demon influenced if not demon possessed. Oh, I don't want to tell people about Jesus because it's going to interrupt the flow of whether or not I am going to be successful in making a couple of bucks. To do what with? To spend on my own lust. And I'll tip God. True. A friend of mine is going on to heaven right now. The Lord exceedingly blessed him. Because people would come to him, and there was many times they would tell me about particular deals that were going to come down that were worth somewhere. Sometimes $250,000, sometimes upwards of $10-15 million. And they would be talking to him about the things, and he'd just shut them right down and said, well, before we go any further, most important thing to me is, where's your soul going to spend eternity? And he lost lots of business because he would stop people right in the process. Where will your soul spend eternity? One simple question. Don't have to go in a big theological. You don't have to do a contrast and comparison between evolution and creation. Where will your soul spend eternity? Because God the Holy Ghost will write upon the wind of those words. And he will burn them and brand them into the heart of the consciousness of man. Because it's God's word that won't return void. Where will your soul spend eternity? Lost many, many, many deals because it would cut people to the core. Slice them. The word of God is sharp. It's living. It's powerful. Sharper than any two-edged sword. Divides asunder soul from spirit. Joint from marrow. It's the one that really, truly reveals what's going on in your heart. And many people don't want to face what's going on in their heart. And then they take it out on the man of God, the one who's the messenger. Just the messenger. And reality of it is, they're going to find out one day. They were all that time taking it out on God himself. They were responding to the Almighty. As they walked away mad, they went into their living room, into their bedroom, into their closets, into their cars, into their daily life, and began to speak out against those who spoke the word of life. Where will your soul spend eternity? Oh, well, I believed upon God. Well, the devils have believed. They're trembling. I haven't seen many of those people shaking lately. They tremble at his presence. God's not interested in whether or not you've heard it and thought it was nice and sounded good and said, yeah, I want to join the club, but never paid the dues. Never willing to obey. Willing to hear, but not willing to obey. God said you must be willing to hear and obey. Both willing and obedient. And we shouldn't have to ring people around, you know, a situation of their soul being lost eternally. They should have, the people that are in this place and across the United States of America have had encounters with God. They've been able to taste and see, many have been able to taste and see how good he is. And then after the meeting, and after the meeting wore off, after 2 or 3 days, if they were in a great meeting, it took 2 or 3 days for the meeting to wear off, they went back to their vomit. They went back to their wallowing. I looked at a sow the other day wallowing in its muck. enjoying it, just enjoying nasty, filthy muck. And you hear the heart of the Father saying, why? I have such glory for you. I have such honor for you. I've invited you to come and sit at my table. And yet you'd rather go and serve mammon. And yet you'd rather go after your own lust. Rather you'd go after your own interest. Tonight we're going to minister on faith. We're going to minister on pure faith and how pure faith is developed and how pure faith works. But there won't be many people that will come. In this state and atmosphere, the spiritual state and atmosphere, for they will hold upon their life so dearly the money they will make tomorrow. Their own lust and interest for their own cares and their own affection and their own pursuit. They will not be in this house of God nor any house of God. They will sit in the realms of secular humanity, in the realms of their own pursuits, in the realms of their own lust, in the realms of their own earthly comforts. To come back and criticize the anointing and disagree with God. And all the time, believe that they do the will of the Lord. And all the time, because of this deceived, self-justified state. If there's ever going to be revival, if there's ever going to be a move of God, people are going to come out from the wickedness of the world. They're going to come out from the lust of the flesh. They're going to come out from immorality. I mean, God has called us into a place of purity that is far more pleasurable than any immoral thing that you've ever heard about, seen, or witnessed. All that immorality will destroy your soul. It will eat inside of you like a cancer. Purity, it will grow into insight and freedom and glory and splendor and majesty and encounter with reality. Eternity begins to knock on your door. You know, when I was looking at the 3 by 3 kilometer church filled with hundreds of thousands of people. Here, just put it up just for just a minute. I'll show more of it tonight. Just listen, I first learned about this church a little over a year ago. And what God is doing in the midst of this church. And understanding what my first thing was in my spirit was, what happened? What happened? And then I came to know and understand that what happened was that one or two men took hold of God. Just play it. I mean, can you just go ahead and play it just for just a minute? Just turn it up and play it.
Let's lift our hands to the Most High God.
In the simplest,
just begin to bless His holy name.
Expressions of faith.
Go ahead, give Him glory, give Him honor.
Went away. It said,
give Him adoration.
I believe your Bible is true. I believe what you said in your word is true. I believe that you really exist, that you're really there. Look at this. That's the church. 3 kilometers by 3 kilometers.
Go ahead, praise
Him. Hundreds of thousands of people there. And he said, no, I care not for my own
praise
life.
Praise him.
I don't even want to live.
Praise the King of Kings.
If I can't have you, I don't even want to exist.
Praise the Lord of
Lords.
Anymore.
Didn't even own a pair of shoes.
Magnify his holy name.
Never was praise had much of anything.
Praise
but
him.
Suddenly somebody told him about Jesus.
He is the Almighty God.
See how many people there? It is hard for you to see. Hundreds of thousands. That's the morning service. You can turn it off.
Give Him glory.
That's the normal attendance. That's a special meeting. And you hear Him pray, oh God, you that is stronger than the strongest, older than the oldest, wiser than the wisest, mightier than the mightiest, higher than the highest. I mean, it's beautiful. For me, all I do is get challenged by that. To say, Lord, whatever it takes. See, what happens is we get in our environments and we're easily assimilated by our environment. It literally, our environment, the people that we hang out with and the people that we socialize with begin to take us over. We begin to think like them. We begin to act like them. We begin to move like them. And God, the Holy Spirit, has called us to come and sit at his table and to interact with him so that we begin to think like him, we begin to act like him, and that our communion is in heaven and our spirit joined unto the Holy Spirit. Then you come to the meeting, you acting like me. Hallelujah. You got a macete di mabrede vita. You shall cut a mosete. You shall cut away that as I'm speaking by the Spirit, it's hard to keep you in your seat. It's true, because it activates the reality of God in your life, because I know that the reality of God has been activated in my life, and it is out of that that I speak. I have not rehearsed this. I'm just speaking out of a realm of that which the Spirit of the Lord has provided. I'm captive. I'm not trying to get you to do anything other than to respond to Christ Jesus, who's invited you into his life to share the glory of the realms of heaven, to be overwhelmed by the power of the Holy Ghost. I don't care how tired you are, how sick you are, how miserable you are, how whatever's going on in your life, God will instantly and totally change it. He is here to absolutely invade your life. I mean, people are consumed with the things and the interests of this life. And when you're unwilling to change, then you hear me speak, and all you have is condemnation. It's not condemnation. It's a calling out. Somebody said, oh, it's condemnation. No, telling you about your sin and the judgments of God against it is not condemnation. It's your opportunity to be liberated. It's the gospel. It's what I'm commissioned to do. You can't just be delighted to hear. You can't just be willing to hear. You got to come under the rule. People don't realize this, but God, Christ Jesus, stands in the midst of his church right now, and his eyes are a flame of fire because of holy indignation. Think about it from his perspective. From his perspective, he's opened up the realms of glory to where that you and I may fully represent the Father, not only in his holiness and his purity, but in his love and his power. To where that not only do men get to see this wonderful life of living out this realms of divine Holy Spirit goodness, but they have all of their needs met, from all their sicknesses and diseases being cured, and all their sins washed away, which brings the heaviness and the sorrow and the guilt and the shame and the condemnation that causes their faces to look so sad and so clouded by oppression. And he sees the church sitting in this place of false representation, saying, this is what it looks like to be redeemed. And he's on fire with jealousy for the name of the Father. He's on fire. And out of his mouth comes a sharp two-edged sword. He said, I've not found you perfect. You repent. Listen to him. I'll come and blot your name out. There's many people that sit in the church today, they've never even really, they've been willing to come and participate like a club, but they've never really had their name even written in the Lamb's Book of Life. To have your name written in the Book of Life, you have to have an event. You have to be born of God. It has to be an encounter where your heart is changed and your spirit is changed. You got a new nature. It's a nature of God. You want what God wants. You love what God loves. You become a child that's willing and obedient. You want to know God. You want to do what's right. Yes. Name written. Name written. Yes. If your name's not written in the Lamb's Book of Life, I'm telling you, you belong to a realm that is darkness that God has already judged. And the time of its judgment is certain, and it's soon to come and be fulfilled completely. And it's an eternity absent of God, filled with nothing but demon powers and all the judgment that is upon their head, and described as a lake of fire and torment throughout the ages. You take the evilest men, the worst things that you can imagine, and that's what's all around you, because you chose to go with it. Oh, I didn't choose to go with it. I just want a couple of sips of wine. Well, if alcohol is so okay, why is it that in every great move of God, you'll hear stories about how men were standing at bars and their hands went frozen. They couldn't take the beer to their lips. Or when the Holy Ghost conviction fell, everybody that had any taste for alcohol suddenly began to despise it. And I could go through the whole list of all the things that people have justified in this modern age, where when the revival and the move of God began to take place, people were no longer interested in their business, no longer interested in their money-making and schemes, no longer interested in living out their own life and pursuing their own interest. If it's so good and okay. No, the Lord said this. He said, if you lose your life, you can have mine. And the reality of it is many people will not let the Holy Spirit, who's the Spirit of truth, begin to talk to them about the reality of whether or not they've really lost their life. And he's not saying, if you lose a fraction of your life, if I, the preacher, and in some of cases, your pastor, and some of you can't even make it to the meeting, you're sitting at home watching on the web, can't identify that you've lost your life, you're in serious trouble. Oh, well, it's between me and the Lord. Oh, yeah, it is. But you know what? God's got himself some people that are trying to scream and holler at you who've got a little bit more insight and say, hey, wait a minute, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm a witness against you. You haven't lost your life. It is not a condemnation thing. It's a thing of, will you come over here and listen and understand what you've got to be willing to do? Will you come and understand here, understand how to be conformed to the image of Christ Jesus, the life of God? We understand simply what God said in his word, which are the spiritual rules, the spiritual descriptions, the spiritual call of God, because the word of God describes to us what Father will do for us, but we've got to agree with them. And if you don't agree with them, it becomes evident to anybody who has. If I were lost in the woods and simulated by self-justification and religiosity, I wouldn't be able to discern any difference between you and anyone else, or myself and anyone else. I'd just be captivated by my own interest. When's the last time you personally reached somebody for Jesus? When's the last time you fasted out of hunger and thirst for righteousness? When's the last time that you said, Lord, today I'm just going to seek you. I've got a breakthrough. When's the last time that happened? I hope you can say yesterday. And we're in hot pursuit today. I hope you can. If you can't, you're in trouble. You're in trouble because you're deceived, saying I've lost my life and I'm living his. You're in trouble. Somebody said, oh, that sounds like works to me. No, it's obedience. It's not works. It's just simply a new kind of life. It's a new description of living. It's saying, look, I'm not happy or satisfied anymore. A great sweeping wind of the Spirit is blowing across all of Africa. Some of the mightiest men on the planet right now stand in the nation of Africa. Just like Eddie Boy, who I just showed you. In Asia, some of the great sweeping winds of revival are taking place right now. Why? Because they're not lost in a Greco-Roman culture, self-justifying their religious state based upon the opinions of men. With simple simplicity, childlike faith, they laid hold upon God. Come to the meeting with the dead. They come to the meeting with the dead. Eddie Boy says, I don't pronounce his name properly, I don't think. He says, simply, Lord, settle their case permanently. Real simple prayers. But the power of God is there. Dead raised to life again. Blind see. It don't take too many, you know, consistently. We'll just bring the dead over there, they'll get raised up. And then all of a sudden, more people. Come on. But what happens is you and I, we spend our lives all week long laboring for that which does not profit. Our mind, our thinking is all in this realm of serving mammon, of serving the interest of our society, whether you're a fireman or a doctor or a policeman or a garbage man, serving the interest of our society, consumed with it to go home, to prop our feet in front of whatever it is that we use for our entertainment or to satisfy our own interest of rest. Well, you need to go to Africa, or you need to go to Asia, where you don't have anything now. And you've got an opportunity for heaven. Reality of it is you don't really have anything either. Now, all you're doing is you're being tempted by another realm, and you fell for the bait. I have friends of mine in China. They say all the time to me, No, we're not sending any of our people to America. Well, why not? Well, just look at your churches. Our people are going to become just like your people. They're going to go to America, and they're going to start all of a sudden want to get education and get a job and start making money, and then they're going to lose everything that they've got. There'll be no more power, no more demonstration of God, no more hunger for God. They'll become just religious. They'll be occupied all day with making money to pay for their house, to pay for the car, to go for a new vacation, to have more clothes, to have more things to consume in their own lust. And then if they tip God with a little bit of money, they really think they've done something great, and then they want to know how it was spent. And you have to ask the question, am I caught in that trap? You have to ask yourself the question, am I caught in that trap? You know what I did when, and I'll just tell you, not only did I do this, many other people did it. When I had to work, when I was working, I didn't have to work, it's just what I chose to do. I was working a full-time job because I could have stepped out in faith and gone in other directions with the local ministry. And, you know, and I'm not going to go into that story and that history. When I worked a full-time job, I devoted myself to say, Lord, as much time as I gave to work, I will give to you. So we got up in the morning, early in the morning, I went to work. And so one of the first things I did to put a bit in my mouth is we had church every night. Preparing for the church service, being in the church service. And then when we weren't having church every night, I gave myself to writing books, to studying the Word. So my kids grew up watching Dad sit at the computer, giving myself, to seeking the Lord, in prayer, crying out to God, in the Word, ministry. Lord, how do we do this? Trying to pioneer radio ministry, trying to pioneer the beginnings of a TV ministry, but I didn't, you know, I didn't understand how to move in faith enough. And then some, you know, some of it is just being able to be able by the anointing to cast vision enough to where people can become participative in it. Somehow I failed there, but I really believe that, you know, God wants to stir everybody up to have a radio ministry and to have a television ministry. We're going to step out and we're going to start doing it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to go after it again. And you know, I want you to understand, you know, it's so important that you begin to live for the ministry. And if you don't know how to, if you don't know how to flow in the anointing, to begin to give yourself, for example, to a radio ministry, television ministry, to functioning in the anointing, to where the lives are changed, where the power of the Word goes and confronts people, then support someone who does. And if you're supporting someone in another city, shame on you. Because it's this city that you're supposed to be sowing into. How then does that become a part of what you are laboring to produce in the place that God is holding you responsible for? And in this instance, San Diego, and maybe your little town, wherever you're from. Maybe it's Escondido. Maybe it's Lakeside. Maybe it's Ramona. Maybe it's Oceanside. Wherever you're from. God wants to produce within your heart a great burden to see heaven come and impact that place, to drive out the darkness out of that place. Yes, Lord. The enemy does everything he can to squelch, to minimize, to try to hide away, to persecute into oblivion, into extinction. Those who have an anointing and a voice from heaven, given to them by God, to confront people in the where they're living now, especially in our society, that will result in you ultimately hearing, "Depart from me, you that work iniquity." I want to just read a couple of verses of Scripture here to you this morning. Just so that I'm going to give you an opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. When I give you an opportunity to accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, I'm not giving you an opportunity to feel like that you've got yourself a spiritual insurance policy. I'm giving you an opportunity to escape the life that you've been living. I'm giving you an opportunity, I said, to escape the life that you've been living. I'm giving you an opportunity to escape the kind of behavior, the kind of lifestyle. I'm giving you an opportunity to escape the tyranny of sin and a desire for it. Sin produces an emotional endocrine response, an emotional response, an addictive response, because it creates feelings in the body, experiences in your whole body, in your temple. Your whole being is a temple. You begin to experience things from sin, whether it's drugs, some kind of immorality, even speaking evil of people. It has an effect on your whole body, your being, fundamental chemistry of your body. God wants to deliver you from that hell. Jesus is the Savior. He's come to deliver you from you, but many people are so happy with them that they're pursuing more of them. They want more of them and want more of what they can produce for themselves. The Lord says, if you'll hearken to my voice, if you'll call upon my name, I'll come and deliver you. And the result is you lose your life. In fact, the encounter with him is you hate your life in this world. You've so encountered the glory of heaven, the supernatural expressions of his divine power, of his divine ability to walk in the Spirit, to live in the Spirit, to speak to the clouds and it does not rain, to speak to the clouds and it does rain, to say to the blind, see. You get so captivated with heavenly vision and revelation and be caught away with him to be able to see nations change, souls beginning to begin with a single soul change, to nations change. Before you see a single soul change, you're going to have a burden that takes you to fast and prayer upon your knees, so that you know how to speak the word of life. Because you can speak your religion, I'm there right now. You gotta look extra hard for finding somebody who wants a religion. You speak, you suddenly begin to find yourself an heir of God, a co-inheritor with Jesus Christ, functioning and flowing in divine power and his divine life. Ooh, you taste of that and you're like, ooh, I hate my life in this world. That life I had in the world, I'm living in the glorious reign of the King of Kings. I don't want to go back to that immorality, that junk, that pig waller, that sow wallering in its muck. A dog returning to lick up its vomit, yum, yum. This is what the Lord says. If you think that you shall, if you think that you should escape the judgments of God because you know them, you're so deceived. And that's Paul's address to the church, to the Jews in Rome, in his address, especially in Romans chapter 2. You know, if the Bible is just something of ideas and stories and memory verses, the life of God has never really come to you. Because the word of God will strike, every word of God will strike personally to you and to your state, not to them. And until you first are willing to be examined by the word of God and by the Spirit of God, you've never really stepped into relationship to say, yes, Lord. Forgive me, Father. This is what I want. I want your life. You need to begin to say, higher than the highest. Use me, oh God. You wake up in the morning and your heart is so filled with the Spirit of the Son that you say, Father, I know the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few. God, make me a laborer. I so desperately want to be used by you. And then, In that communion with God, there becomes an encounter with God every day. So this is a morning sacrifice. God's called you and I to be a living sacrifice. We were singing the other night by the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, take me and place me on the altar of your praise. Let your fire fall. Let your fire burn in me. See, it's this that we begin to be a participant with every day, morning and evening and at noon. Will I pray? And there's an encounter. It's the sacrifice. It's the living sacrifice. It's holy and acceptable unto God, where the fire and the passion and the purposes of God beginning to burn in your life. A lot of people are talking about the fire of God, but the fire of God is an all-consuming fire of his holiness and presence. that causes you to begin to go to your knees and say, oh God, I know your harvest is as plenteous and your laborers are few. Oh God, use me. I don't want to impress people and say, oh, that person is really religious. Oh, they're just really a special Christian. Oh, that's just so good for them. I want a confrontation of the power of God with the power of Satan that's ruling their life. Because until then, all they are is impressed with you. They've never encountered the God that you say you serve. It's time that you and I become servants of the Most High God rather than servants of ourselves. We're trying to impress everybody around us, what they think about us. Oh, they're warming up to the idea. That's not the move of God. The move of God is an encounter. It's a radical confrontation with the presence of the Almighty, which He has ordained be realized through our lives as His temples, as His dwelling place, as His ambassadors. I never forced anybody to live in divine health. I saw that it was available. I forced myself and stepped into it out of relationship, not out of some kind of desperate. Same with soul, same with healing, same with signs and wonders, same with anything. Tongues, interpretation of tongues. There's a flow. I must have it. I place a demand upon it. Who am I demanding? Me. God's commanded. Now I'm demanding me. You talk about demanding God. Somebody said, isn't the word ask in the Greek language, like in John chapter 14, isn't it really demand? No. It's ask. It can be, that particular Greek word can be translated demand, but it's not there. It's simply ask, like a son to a father. The demanding needs to go on your part because you're sitting around living a sloppy life spiritually. You live in your life. And it's about time God's people go to their knees and say, I'm done. Put me upon the altar, oh God, of your praise, and let your fire fall. And then that's not going to happen the longer you sit around in religion accommodating you and putting God on some kind of, you know, part-time basis. Deception will take hold of you. It will. The only way to break that is through fasting and prayer. More people need to start fasting with us. We're going to go around sounding a trumpet. We've modeled things and talked about it for years. But it shouldn't be where we got to grab a hold of you like a pump that's, you know, needs to be primed. Saying, come on, worship, man. Come on, worship. Come on, praise Him. Come on. Cry out to God. If you're standing in His presence, go ahead. Come on. Love on Him. Come on. Flow with the Holy Ghost. Come on. Seek the Lord. Seek His face forevermore. Come on. With fasting and praying, with supplication, with crying and tears. Shouldn't be that way. I'm going to tell you why it is. Because if you compromise with the system of the world, it's because of the cares of this life, deceitfulness of riches and pleasures, it chokes the word. And if you can't get it, sorry. If it's not real to you, you need to get real. If I could take you right now to the threshold, I could take you on a church outing today, a church field trip, and I could take you up to the edge of hell and cause you to say, look down in there. This is the place of everyone who refuses the rule of God. This is the place of sin and iniquity. Do you want to continue on in sin and iniquity? If everybody had the consequences of the penalty of sin and iniquity as soon as it was done, there wouldn't be so many people choosing it. But the consequences is just as real. Just God in His mercy gives us an opportunity to repent. But people, the more you give yourself to these things, the stronger the hold is upon your life and the likelihood that you'll never break away. For its deceitfulness of sin will harden your heart. And who does it harden it against? God, the Holy Ghost. He can't convict you. You knew early on, but no, there was something wrong with that. God's saying, don't do that. Don't walk in that way. But you kept self-justifying because everybody else was doing it, or it seemed not to be so bad. And suddenly it wasn't conviction anymore. And if anybody talks about suddenly you're upset, now what once was conviction is condemnation because you disagree. And the only reason that you disagree is because you justified it to have it in your life. You first and foremost disagreed with God so that you could disagree with the man of God. And in that whole state, the reading of the word begins to wane. Fasting and prayer is really not even on your calendar. You sit asleep in the light. God gives you people, and you said, oh, speak into my life. Whatever you see, I'll listen. And then people speak into your life. God heard you. And then the word of the Lord comes forth, and you just ignore it. I disagree. I don't think he's seeing the whole picture. You shouldn't ask God to rule your life in the first place. Because now the judgment's worse. People need to come under the rule. By the help and the grace of God, I'm not going to tell people what my own opinion is or what I think they should do with their life. I'm just going to quote the word. I found it very safe. Somebody said to me the other day, said, how did you have so many answers for the things like they were, they were being asked some questions by someone? How is it that these answers just flow out? I just quote the word. Notice I'm just quoting the word. It's not my opinion. I'm just quoting the scripture for you. You want me to give you the references? Why don't you just read the Bible and start quoting scripture? You'll have the answers too. I'm not giving my answers. Well, I think... No, I gave myself. I'm hungry to be used by God. Lord, your harvest is plenteous. Your laborers are few. You know, when I look at Oedipo, I see the men who paid the price. The early days of Reinhard Bonnke. The other unknowns. Livingston's. Other unknowns. The many who said, okay, Lord, who could have been as successful and probably even more successful in the realms of making money and having a house and driving a car and having clothes and having friends and love of ease and luxury as anyone else. I said, Lord, I'll go lay down my life in Africa. I'll go lay down my life in China. I'll go lay down my life in San Diego. It'd be the hardest place for you to lay down your life. Everybody around the world says the hardest place. It's serving God in the midst of the fire, serving God and with all these temptations, all these other things that you can do, with all these other opportunities, with all the doctors and the doctors. And if they had doctors, most of them don't have any money to pay for it. But one of the things they told that Pastor Adiabo told a friend of mine was, they've got a real problem in the church. Right now they're still counting the offering from July. I said, they're still counting the offering from July. They're behind. You got hundreds of thousands of people each day. Many of their church services go from 6 in the evening to 6 in the morning. That's the night meetings. See, does that fit into your life? No. Americans, most churches had to shut down their evening meetings because people wouldn't come. And they're just like, why are we even doing this? I don't understand. I can understand the pastor. Why am I even doing this? A fraction of the people here, we're just not going to have Sunday night services. If they're going to stay at home, we'll just join them. This week, we're going to have a meeting Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night. And then the week after, we'll just do Wednesday night and Friday night. And then the week after that, we're going to do another Wednesday night, Thursday night, Friday night. This week, we're going to do it with Tim Hall. 2 weeks from now, we're going to do it with Debbie Rester. And I pray that you start doing meetings all day long yourself. But if you do not know how to receive... See, God creates the church and created the church in Christ Jesus to give you an impartation so that you would know how yourself to move in God. But if you don't know how to hook up with the church, and if all you can do is just grunt out a few praises and that's a strain on your voice, you know, a little sore throat afterwards, not much is going to happen for you tomorrow because you never received the divine empowerment and the ability to enjoy this life. God's calling you. He's put forth his voice. He's calling you. God put forth his voice. He's calling you. I pray that every one of you, where'd Sandy go? I guess she had something she had to do. I pray every one of you start a meeting somewhere so you can find out how little anointing you have. I pray, because what's going to happen is you're going to get upset, and right about the crisis, about a month, you're going to have suddenly, you know, the few people you had coming, half of them are going to leave, and it's your crisis point. Then you're going to have to start dealing with you. You're going to either get all upset with you and your inability to do anything, or you're going to have to start touching God and recognize, wait a minute, you know what? I pray that you lose your life and have his and start doing what it is he told you to do. And you get it hooked up with God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And you start being what God describes in his Bible instead of a pretend fake Christian. A plastic Christian with their plastic Bible written by men and confirmed by all the others of like mind. Grab a hold of the living God according to what he's written in his word by bowing in obedience to everything he says, saying, Lord, yes, I want that. Not going, oh, Father, that's good. That's great for you. I'm glad that works for you. I was dealing with a person about their soul yesterday. And I just really began to cut right to the heart of where they're at. Well, I don't want to do that. I don't believe that I have to worship Jesus like that. I believe that we can worship Jesus with peyote and with other hallucinogens. Well, how about your hallucinogens? How about what? Your drug. Just a little different sort. Just a little different sort. Don't tell me. I know the spirit of it. I said to him, I said, well, you know, I got his name. I have your name. His name is Daniel Swimmer, a Lakota Indian. Daniel Swimmer, I've called the fire of God down on you. You say, oh, that's just words. Uh-huh. Watch. You'll either get right or you'll get worse. You're going to either fall more in love with Jesus or you're going to get more rebellious. Do a little test on yourself. Huh? It's true, people. I'm telling you right now. And it's not men that you're interacting with. It's his church. It's the living God. Somebody says, control. No control here. You can do whatever you want to do. We're not going to do what you're trying to control us to do. We're not going to preach your sermons, sing your songs, and dance your dances. We're going to preach his sermons, sing his songs, amen, and dance his dances. We're going to pray his prayers. Hallelujah. We're going to faithfully. I'm not called to do what another man is doing. I'm called to do what God has given me to do, to faithfully speak the words which he's put within my mouth, not for another nation, but for this nation. Now, when I go to other nations, God gives me a different word to speak to Cuba, give me a different word to speak to Kashmir, Nepal, wherever it is that he's sending me, to Africa. It's a different word to speak. But to you, here in America, God's put a word in my mouth for Americans. I know it's the Father who's done it. How you respond to it is, it may not be a revelation to you about where your state is, but it is a revelation to me about how you are responding to him. It's the Spirit of the Lord. And just because you don't have a discernment to recognize it's the Holy Ghost speaking to you, that is all that is not somehow not your fault. No, it is a description of the state of your soul, of the state of your soul. And we're here to see your soul healed, changed. But you're going to have to be willing to be obedient. The Lord says in Isaiah chapter 13 and verse 11, and please, I want you to understand that this is a proclamation that the Lord says over and over again. He says it so many times. He lifts up his voice crying out so many times. And people are going to have to hear it. Understand this. And I, God speaking, he said, and I will punish the world for their evil and the wicked for their iniquity. And I will cause the arrogance of the proud to cease, and I will lay low the haughtiness of the terrible. You know, when you go to 1 Peter, go to 2 Peter with me real quickly, and you can understand this punishment. God is the same yesterday and today and forever. He's the same God of the Old Testament as the New Testament. He's not changed about sin and the way he feels about rebellion and evil and wickedness. And Israel and their response to God is a great witness to all of us, because here they are going to church in the temple saying they know God, and God says to them that he tells them that they are not his people, that they are not serving him, and that all that they do is an abomination and a reproach to him, and that their sacrifices do not smell good. They're a stench, and he's not anywhere near them. He lays it out there. It's like Jesus talking to the seven churches in the book of Revelation, chapter 1 through 3, especially chapter 2 through 3. First and foremost, before he begins to talk to them, he reveals who he is. He says, I'm standing in the midst of the church. My eyes are beholding everything that's going on. He's not going to be King of Kings. He is already King of Kings. The Messianic age is not coming. It's already here. The most venerated rabbi of our day, Rabbi Yitzhak Katuri, photographic mind, everybody went to him for everything, most venerated rabbi in Israel. Before he died in 2006, he had a visitation from Jesus. And he told everybody, I'm going to write the name of the Messiah. He said, when he was 12 or 13 years old at his bar mitzvah, a rabbi in the place where he was at said, you're going to see the Messiah before you die. Before he died, he had an encounter with the Messiah. He wrote down his name, said, you can't read his name till after my death. He died within a few months. They opened up and they read his name, and he said, Yehoshua, Jesus. He called the name of the Messiah. His name is Yehoshua. Now there's a movement among rabbis to reinvestigate Jesus, because all they understood Jesus was from the mentality of Constantine and a Roman Catholic interpretation of Jesus, which was entirely a mixture of Christianity with Mithras, which we all know. All the symbols are there. Everybody knows it. The Jesuits even know it. The reality of it is it's the same kind of paganism and the same kind of mixture goes on all throughout the church. There's a mixture continually going on of secularism with the things of the Spirit, with unholiness with holiness, with the purity of the stream of what God the Holy Ghost would do, and interacting with devil, sin, and iniquity, and a lust and a desire for things that are evil. And the Roman Catholic Church doesn't have a handle on it. It just, a corner on the market, so to speak. It's just that they were the more popular voice speaking. You know what I'm saying? But praise God for a revival where they're reinvestigating the Messiah. It's just the beginning. It's just the beginning. God didn't take away the veil. It's going to happen during the tribulation when the Father takes away the veil. Father is coming with his wrath and holy indignation to execute judgment upon all the ungodly. If you're in the camp of the ungodly, if you even smell like the world, you are in direct fire, ground zero of the execution of his wrath and indignation. Because sin and iniquity is very twisted. It's very evil. And people got to wake up. Peter says this in 2 Peter chapter 3. He says this. He says that verse 7, that the heavens and the earth, and let me just say this, how does God and his witness of his executing of judgment and wrath against sin and iniquity, what does it look like? The flood. the flood of Noah and the days of Noah. This is what it looks like. Every living thing wiped out in the act of his mercy to preserve something that is still able to be salvaged. Not just an act of judgment, always an act of mercy too. To destroy wickedness before the plague destroys everything, like a disease. Are we going to praise everybody at the NIH who's trying to find, you know, a cure for the new plague or the new virus? We're not going to praise God for his execution of his righteous judgment against sin and iniquity, which is the worst plague of all? We're going to somehow find a fault against him because we end the plague. We end the disease. And we like it. He says, verse 6, referring to the judgments before, Sodom and Gomorrah is another judgment. How God executes his judgment against sin and iniquity. So I want to make sure people say, well, you know, everybody can interpret the Bible for themselves. Interpret Sodom and Gomorrah for me. Oh, the Bible, everybody interprets it. That's a direct lie against God. He said the scripture is not for any private interpretation. It's plain and simple. Interpret the flood in the days of Noah. Interpret that. Interpret a lake of fire. Interpret the judgment of God executed against all unrighteousness. It is what it is in the days of Noah. It is what it is in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. The judgments upon Israel, the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom. The judgments that Jesus Christ describes in Revelation chapter 2 and Revelation chapter 3, we stand in the midst of the church saying, your work is not perfect. Repent, or I will come and remove your candlestick. I'll blot out your name. I'll remove you out of the book of life. I will fight against you with the sword of my mouth. Listen, read it. I'm not going to have my name polluted. I'm not going to have my name profaned, because there's somebody out there that really wants the life I have to offer. And all you're doing is interfering, saying that the life that you're living is the life that I gave. And it isn't. It's polluted with demon spirits, with sin and iniquity. And God's a jealous God. And if you want to understand something about him, he's a jealous God. And he doesn't want his name polluted. And he doesn't want false representation of his goodness. Why? Because there's somebody out there that really wants to live life. And all you're going to do is stop and stop them, pervert judgment. And God's going to always be on the side of the innocent and the poor and the needy. If you and I stand in the way of God, say, as false representations of the life that Christ Jesus gave when he poured out his blood at Calvary's cross, of the life that he gave when he rose up from the dead, of the life that he gave when he poured out the Holy Ghost, the promise of the Father from on high, you are in serious, we are in serious, serious trouble of eternal damnation. That's the way it is. And until sobriety begins to take a hold of your heart and you begin to quit self-justifying and lay out the word of God, quit acting like you're so such a special case before the Lord, and recognize that he's no respecter of persons, that he judges every man according to his word. He will not pervert judgment just so that he can accommodate you or me. Suddenly, the fear of God will begin to be able to have some place to work within our heart and our life. People say, must you holler and scream? Yes, this is serious matters. Your house is burning down around you. And anybody who's trying to save somebody from death, they're going to be screaming and hollering out and fighting for the life. If they have any care for humanity, if they have any concern or love in their heart. Mine's higher and more intense because it's the Father's concern and his love. People self-justifying and accommodating their life that God has condemned too long. It's about time you get real with God. Let the floodlight of heaven shine upon your soul. Let the word of God be what it is and say, am I living this or not? And when you begin to get serious with God, heaven will invade your life and you will find the power and the ability and the strength no longer to pollute the life, no longer to pollute the flow of the Spirit. And what's going to happen is you're going to begin, you'll just step into the grand prize. Hallelujah. You'll just get real enough to get rid of all the stuff that's been hindering you from getting blessed. That's all that's good. You'll get real enough to get delivered from all the things that's been robbing you of the riches of His goodness and of His glory and the flow of His presence in your life. Father shouting to try to get you out of darkness. He's shouting to try to get you out of the tyrannical reign of someone who hates your soul and hates your life and imposes upon you addictions and imposes upon you all kinds of iniquity and immorality, enslaves you with sin so that he can destroy your soul while you're living and eternally in hell. It's true. Because sin's always only good for while you're doing it. Right afterward, it starts reaping its destruction. It starts reaping its consequences. Huh? Peter says this, the heavens and the earth which are now by the same word of God, the same word of God that brought judgment upon the earth that then was, and it was overthrown with a flood, the same judgment, that the same word of God that brought judgment upon Sodom and Gomorrah because of the iniquity, the same word of God that brought judgment upon the northern kingdom Israel because of their disobedience and unwillingness to hear, the same word of God right now reserves the heaven and the earth at this moment in time, and it holds it up for a day of judgment in which the fire of God will burn against perdition and ungodly men. Rebellion and sedition summarizes perdition. I'm doing it my way around here. You know why? I'm in charge of my own life. I mean, you know, perdition is personified in the Antichrist. I'm God. But there's many ways to say that. More subtly, more in a way to accommodate your own frame of reference about what you believe is right and wrong. But let me tell you right now, people, men do not have the discernment to know truly the difference between right and wrong. It is always going to be polluted with your own perception and idea and self-justification. Only God can show you, only the Spirit of the Lord can reveal to you what truly is the difference between right and wrong, good and evil. Father defines good. He defines right. And it's only found in His presence and only found by His Spirit. And there is none good but God. And when you, if you want to be that found good in Him, you're going to have to begin to be living your life by Him and through Him. Which means, Holy Ghost, take control of my life. That means pornography's got to go. That means your diddle-dallying around on computers and being drawn in by that stuff has got to go. That means your hate talk has got to go. That means those things of depression and rebellion and arrogance has to go. You're doing it your own way. You need to come under the rule. Who rules you? Come on. You do. Women don't even let their husbands rule them. Most husbands aren't worthy to rule because they're going to do it with their own ideas. Whose governorship are you under? Oh, I relate to a pastor in Australia. Well, you need to move to Australia quickly so they can smell your breath and look in your ornery face and help you understand how much you are just totally consumed with yourself and God has barely an opportunity to get in. No, people don't want to come under the rule. It's perdition. It's sedition. I'm doing it my way. Leave me alone. And then they go look for somebody who agree with them.
Did you hear what Pastor said to me?
Yeah, I know. He's really rough. I don't know why he's so rough. I feel sorry for you, counselor. You false prophet. You one who perverts judgments and turns away righteousness. Huh? God said by His prophets, your damnation is just. People doing that all the time, not repenting for it. They think it's okay. Well, I can't relate. I don't know why he's that way. He loves God. I don't know why he's that way. He stole from them their eternal life. It would have been better that you had been not even born. It would be better that you had committed suicide before you did that. You better shut up. You better get in agreement with God's word. If you don't have discernment and understanding, you can't speak the word of God, better be quiet, because God said if they don't speak according to his word, it's because they have no light in them. That means they're full of the devil. That's what Isaiah said. I'm just going to lay it down to you, which is about time your expressions quit being consumed by the God of this world so that he begins to be separated unto the Lord so you can get excited in the meeting. The place sounds like a Holy Ghost shout where there's somebody around who's got a light of God's glory being revealed through their life, a moving of the Holy Ghost that can sound out the praise and the worship of the Most High. Because if you don't have that, you don't have nothing. Hello. Hello. And if you don't agree with me right now, you don't agree with God. Because I'm declaring his word. You don't agree with him? A lot of you don't agree with God. They don't agree with his ways. They think he's too harsh. He's too intense. He's too severe. No. You just understand. God's given us, you're looking at it wrong. You're looking at it from the perspective of holding on to sin, holding on your own way, and holding on your own opinion. God has provided us into a bunch of do's. He's invited us into a bunch of life. Huh? We just got to cry out and say, listen, you're living over in a realm of your ways and your walk. And so therefore there's nothing but no. But step over here in God's life and everything is yes. It's all that you can have, and it's all that you can do, and it's the abundance of all things freely to enjoy. It's like it's really, in many respects, it's really the same kind of ratio. God said you can have everything. It all belongs to you. That's thousands upon thousands of things there in the garden of God. And he says one thing, you can't have my tree of knowledge, good and evil. And it's really about the same ratio. But people over there in that realm of disobedience, and we're telling them everything about your life is wrong. And if you come over here into the light where now you have all things freely to enjoy, and now you want to start going back to your former conversation, somebody's going to be screaming at you saying, are you crazy? Have you lost your mind? Don't lick the vomit. Don't wallow in the muck. Well, I just don't think it's that bad.
It is that bad.
And it's robbing you.
It's robbing you. Sometimes I wonder what's worse. The cares of this life and the deceitfulness of riches and the pleasures of this world that choke the word so that the fruit of your life looks like what God described in Mark chapter 13, or forgive me, Matthew chapter 13, which makes you a false witness. Or just blatant, full out, immorality. Because it truly is the little foxes that spoil the grape of my beloved's garden. Revival will only come in your life because you respond to the revivalist and the revival spirit, the moving of the Holy Ghost. And that's serious business. And that's radical. And that's passionate. And that's determined. And that's laying hold of God. And it don't matter what it takes, I'm taking hold of him. I'm going to have the praises of God and the flow of the Spirit of God in my life that produces a majesty, whether I'm whispering or whether I'm shouting. Hallelujah.
It's up to you. God's made it available. You've just got to believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. And the Lord said, in light and view of this judgment, that the same word that spoke of judgment in the past and it came to pass, the same word that spoke of judgment that now is concerning the heavens and the earth which now exist. And he says in verse 8, he says, listen, I don't care. Understand this. With me,
everything is the same. I'm exactly the same as I was 1,000 years ago and as today. A day, in my perspective of the way I feel and my judgments and what I've said and how it's going to come to pass, it's certain today as it was 1,000 years ago. 1,000 years is the same as a day. A day is the same as 1,000 years. It's not some kind of new time scale. It's not some kind of new, you know, scale of addition. It's just the Lord saying, I'm nothing's changed here. I'm exactly the same as I was when I destroyed the earth with water. I'm exactly the same as it was when I created a chaos of darkness because of Satan's rebellion. I'm exactly the same as I was when I brought executed judgment against Sodom and Gomorrah. I'm exactly the same as I was. And he goes through it. People better listen. The day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that therein shall be burned up. Bring me Ezekiel. And Papa and Mama come with Ezekiel. Is Mama doing good? Mama's healthy, strong. And Ezekiel, Mr. Ezekiel. Mr. Ezekiel. Hallelujah. Listen, Mr. Ezekiel, sleepy old sleepyhead. Oh, thou that sleepest. No, he's just preparing. He's got a lot of work to do. He's resting up. Saving his energy. Got a lot of work to do. You know, today, Cade and Ruthenna are coming and dedicating this life to the Lord. They're not going to train him to be amazing in the eyes of men. They're not going to train him up in mathematics and history and science. They're not going to train him up in all those things that everybody else thinks is, you know, wonderful and amazing. They're not going to train him up to be a Nobel Prize winner. They're going to train him up to be a prophet of the Lord. So they named him Ezekiel. Ezekiel James. You know, two mighty names. But not just name, well, I want a good name. Naming him to prophesy over him that they may understand how to handle him all the days of his life. You know, when Hannah is a great example to you and I of how we can take our life and consecrate our life to the Lord and God do mighty things through us and change nations and change generations, where that what we did and what we consecrated is talked about for thousands of years. We've been talking about what Hannah did for thousands of years. For more than 3,000 years, we've been talking about a consecration that Hannah made when she came to the Lord and she said, Lord, I can't take it anymore. I can't take being barren anymore. And it went so deep into her spirit. It was so deep. It wasn't just, oh, now lay me down and sleep. I pray the Lord. Oh, God, if you can get around to it, you can see your way clear. Please, you know, give me a baby. It was deep. It wasn't just some kind of surface, casual prayer. And not really that. It's not that important to me. But you know what? It would be nice. This prayer is so deep from the being. It's like, I can't go on living without this. When you get real with God, boy, does he get real with you. When we get real with God, my, does he get real with my. When we step into a place where we say, you are God and you are your ma, where God begins to be revealed in our lives. And that consecration that day, Lord, just give him to me. And as soon as he weaned, I'd give him to you. Let me just enjoy him until he's weaned. That day, before he was even conceived, he was consecrated to be given over to God, to the house of the Lord. Be children. I don't see many people. I got to the point where I didn't want to dedicate children. Even people don't even mean it. Because they tried to go, no. You're giving your kids to the church, and then you don't even show up to church. And if what you many people model to their kids, it's ultimately going to be the result of the life. They'll spend eternity in hell. They give them everything but what they need. They made church. They so deprioritized church
that your kids learn more from what you do than from what you say. And you made it to church, what, Sunday morning, Sunday night? They saw you sitting at home. God's not real.
You come and you dedicate your church, kids to the Lord. First of all, you need to dedicate your life to the Lord. You need to get real. You need to get real with God and quit playing pretend and listen to some counselor who's ungodly to justify your response to God. You need to stay in the house of the Lord. That's what consecration looks like. It was shown to us by Samuel. And that's what dedication to the Lord is about. We dedicate children to the Lord based upon what Hannah did with Samuel. We dedicate children to the Lord based upon what God told us how to raise our children in Deuteronomy. How to instruct them in the way when they rise up. How to instruct them in the way when they sit down. How to instruct them in the way of God when they lay down. How to instruct them in the obedience of all that God has said to keep the things of the Spirit, in that particular instance, to keep the things of the law first. What will you do with your life? It is forever. I can't help it that somehow some lying spirit has got a hold of you and you believe the imaginations of some fallible man over the goodness of God that he gave to us and extended to us when he poured out his blood at Calvary and by many proofs and by many evidence made clear of who he is and the judgments that he has. Don't be so foolish that you should hang on to your life and believe something out of your fallible, existence and the fallible perceptions of men to spend an eternity in a place called the wrath of God. When all the time, the day you were born, he was pleading with you and begging you to let him bless you, to let him fill you with his life. And you cried out every time, oh, give me death, give me death. I want death, I'll take death. God pleads, no, take life. No, I give you my life. I'll do anything that you might have my life. No, I'll take death. I want death. Give me death. The Lord finally says, you may have what you want. Hear me. People say, well, I don't believe a loving God sent anyone to hell. You send yourself to hell every day. Your hell is your creating. Nobody on the planet is going to choose, as it were, in their right mind, to be sad when they could be happy. People aren't in their right mind. The chaos and the destruction, God didn't work that. You worked that. Man worked that. God created man in a paradise, a fellowship, and everything. Man chose to walk out of it. Man chose to rebel against God. And so it goes on today in your life. In my life, if I were to choose, if I were to do it my own way, I'm going to obey God's word and walk in his word because his word alone is light unto my feet and light unto my path. I'm going to let his word rule over me because only by his word can I discern good and evil. Can I know how to do what is right? It's only by his word that I can hook up with the Holy Spirit. And God told us to get ourselves in the meeting and more as we see the day approaching. And they were having meetings two times a day and you can't make it to church once a month. And you can't make it to Sunday night. We have church. The assembly here is Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, sometimes Friday night. And then there's every once in a while, there's extra meetings. They're not substitutes. Well, I'm not going to go to Sunday night. I'm going to go to Tuesday night. No. That's a substitute meeting. And then that's not the meeting. You don't go to Sunday night. You don't even have the right to go to Tuesday night. Unless you're not even here. And if I were there, I'd kick you out. So now you weren't in church on Sunday night. Sorry. You can come next time. Adiapo is saying it in that meeting that I was just showing you. Some of your hygiene is very bad. Get your hygiene right or we will beg you not to come back. We will plead with you. Go somewhere else. good man. Keep the thing right. I mean, I haven't talked to any of you about your hygiene yet. It's pretty cool, huh? Did you guys listen the whole day? Oh, it's great. Today we had 26 girls born in the meeting. Who knows how many people died? I mean, I don't know. Probably no one. The rest were boys. It's a little off scale. I'm sure we will make up for it to the next meeting. Isn't that cool? How can you have a church, hundreds of thousands of people, 6 in the evening to 6 in the morning? You're going to have a lot going on. Hallelujah. Come on, I just want to see it. I just want to see it. But you know what? You're not going to see anything that you don't want to participate in now. Let me say it again. You're not going to see anything that you don't want to participate in now. I believe God is taking a hold of Ezekiel James. He's going to be like an Ezekiel of the Old Testament. What a radical prophet. His tongue cleaved to his mouth so he would not speak unless he was speaking the word of God. God used him to unveil so many wonderful things about his God's judgment, to declare and describe to men, you better get right, you better flee from the wrath to come because it is coming, buddy, whether you believe it or not, whether you agree with it or not, wrath is coming against sin and all ungodliness and all worldliness. God said, you come out, you a friend of the world, you're my enemy. If you're so high on the next movie that's coming down the pike, I'm going to tell you right now, you in the wrong perspective. If you're running with all the ideas and the thinking of men, you wouldn't, look, if you want to do it, you know what? Come on, people. If you're going to act like the world, live like the world, you'll die like the world. James, the first apostle taken, killed because of what a radical preacher, my goodness. Kill the most radical first. It was James. Huh? Peter was second in line. You hear me? Peter was second in the line. James was the most radical. He was one of the sons of thunder. The other son of thunder, they killed the first son of thunder right off the bat. Second son of thunder, they couldn't kill him. He wouldn't die. They tried. And that means every day we're modeling for him. Every day, huh, is take him up and begin to pray and cry out to God. From the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. Consecrated to the Lord. He probably wouldn't even want an iPhone. You know? So many of the mighty men of God who took hold of the things of God, one of the radical displays of their life is they didn't like anything that everybody else liked. They didn't like newspapers. They didn't want anything secular. There's grief to them. Pretty radical, huh? For all of you guys who are addicted to as the world turns, and days of our death, days of our lives, and all the other things that people go on and sit there and take in to their bosom, communion with demon spirits, and say it's harmless. It's not harmless. It's actually training you how to think, act, move. It teaches you how to be more sensitive to demon spirits and more cooperative with them. That's what all ministry does. Whether it's demonic ministry or Holy Ghost ministry. If it's Holy Ghost ministry, it'll teach you how to be more sensitive and cooperate with the Holy Ghost. If it's demonic ministry, all it's going to do is teach you how to be more sensitive and cooperative with demon spirits. Truth, not fact. Truth. I'm taking this baby up in my hands before their mother and before his mother and father. Describe unto you a consecration that God is looking to have of your life. He's not going to be all upset because he's got to go do what mom and dad wants to do today. Can you see that? Mom and dad is going to get in there right front and center in everything in ministry, and they're going to include him in everything. I was looking at some friends of mine the other day, the way their children are turning out, just full of the Holy Ghost. I said, you're doing it right. And the person turned to me and said, thank you. I said, don't stop doing what you're doing. And what they're doing is they're full on in the ministry, and they're including their kids in everything that they're doing. And mom and dad are one in it, totally one in it. They're not arguing, not arguing. A house divided cannot stand. Hallelujah. And there's one leader, and the leader is the father. You know, God's given the man a special anointing. He gives this man a special anointing to lead. Maybe he would disregard it. But it's just as special as anointing, as a prophet, as a king, as a priest. Special anointing to lead. Hallelujah. And when we're serious about our anointing, we're serious about the grace that has been given to us. Boy, we wait upon our ministry. We don't make run with ideas off the top of our head. We fast and pray over them after we know we received them from God. Well, God said to do it, now let's fast and pray over it. Come on, people, quit living your own life and calling it God. Quit living after the imaginations of your own ideas and calling this leading of the Holy Spirit. You got to be trained through discipline and submission and consecration and choices, right, and making the right choices to be led by God. Just simple faith and he'll do it. Simple faith. Simple faith that says, I'm all in, Lord. I dedicate him to you. Lord, we dedicate Ezekiel James to you. Father, Kay dedicates Ezekiel James to you. Father, Ruth Anna dedicates Ezekiel James to you, to your house, to your ministry, to giving him over to your servants, to lead them, to guide them. Hallelujah. Show me children that were given over someplace by their parents. Their parents held them back, or they were given over by their parents to the church, for the church to rule them and to raise them. And they fear and admonition of the Lord with their complete support and cooperation doing it at home. And I'll show you people who stepped into the anointing of the Holy Ghost and didn't have a fraction of the problems and issues that everybody else had. That's what dedication is. They're saying, we're giving Ezekiel James to the church. He comes under the rulership and the authority of the church. The rulership and the guidance and authority of the church is more important than our personal leadership and guidance and authority. It's just like somebody saying, yes, we're going to teach our children, Father, your way, your law. We're going to send them to the rabbi. We're going to send them to the priest and let the priest describe to us and tell to us all that we should do. And if we find a sickness or a disease upon them, we're going to present it to the priest and let the priest diagnose it. It's not only physical, it's spiritual. What's going on with my child? Let me look into your child. Oh, here's what's going on. Change that right now. It's your attitude. Shoo. We reproduce after our own kind. And all what God wants to do, he wants to raise up a mighty a mighty family, a mighty army, a mighty people of the Spirit, to come under his correction, his discipline. Somebody said, I want to be your punching bag. You need to come under the rule of God's rod of iron, where he smashes everything. Huh? I want to come under his rule of him smashing everything. Rebellious, arrogant attitudes of people. You change right now. Because God has given you the power of change. God commands you to change. It's the ministry of change. Reconciliation means change. New birth means change. Repent means change. God commands everybody everywhere, repent. Get right, right now. It's not like he said, nah, you know what, hey, baby. It's not like he says, some of you guys, nah, I'm excluding you, you can't. You're too weird. He's commanding everybody, everywhere to repent. And it's an act of, it's love language. It's mercy saying, come, I'll accept you. I'll be yours. You'll be mine. But you, everything about your life has got to change. I don't like nothing about you. People get all upset about that. Well, I like everything about me. I like nothing about you. And as soon as I give you my life, you won't like nothing about you either.
because I got a life for you so much better. You've been shaped in the image and the likeness of demon spirits. You've been shaped in the image and the likeness of everything that is evil. And I want to shape you in the image and the likeness of everything that is good. Amen. And if you have a problem with that, fundamentally you have a problem with God. With everything that he says in his word and everything that Jesus Christ stands for. So get on one side or the other. And I'm not telling you some kind of philosophical ideology about God. I'm declaring to you his word and what he says. Man was born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And every man that came into this world was under that yoke of condemnation. But God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe would not perish. The whole world lies in wickedness. All men have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That sin of Adam passed upon all men. And judgment passed with it. And now Father has made a way for you and I to be born again. To start all over, to start anew, to be born in righteousness and every day shaped in holiness. But you're going to have to quit doing it your own way and become a consecrated baby. And you're going to have yourself some spiritual parents, which are pastors. Hallelujah. Because that's the way God chose. Well, I just don't want to agree with any man. I just don't want to trust any man. Well, you're on your own, buddy. You're on your own. Fare thee well. You know, because I'm going to tell you right now, your plan's going to work out just as bad for you as anybody else's plan. I would be more afraid of my own plan than someone else's. If I had any sense of reasoning. Any investigative skills. Huh? But Papa's come, man. I'm telling you, he's come. He's come. He's watching over his word. I'm telling you right now, you won't ask of him something good and get something evil. No, you come to him. I'm telling you, make sure he's going to make sure that his pastors and the ministers of his, praise God, will speak according to his word. And every day you got a reference book to find out whether or not I'm right. You got a reference book. Don't go ask some, you know, religious opinion. They're going to be against me. Go to the source. Go to the Word of God. Reference books say, yep, there it is, right there. That's what God said. It hurts, but I'm going to do it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. We just thank you, Father, that Ezekiel James is going to be such a proper child. He won't ever have to be spanked. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. Just pray in the Holy Ghost. Just talk all day long with the Word. Said no evil thing in front of him. Don't let the unrighteous handle him. That way every evil spirit will be foreign to him. He won't get used to being cuddled by those full of demon spirits. Amen. Huh? I can't say this to everybody. True. God said, come out from among them, be separate, says God. Not everybody will obey us. A lot of people smile and shake their head and say, oh, yeah, I'm all in. Yeah, you're all in. If one toe counts for being all in. It's not one toe doesn't count, the whole body, the whole being. Jesus. Mambrasitaya. I just so happen to believe that when we take our children, we consecrate them to the Lord, and we do it God's way, that Father raises them up to be mighty,
I so believe that when a people will come together and consecrate themselves to a community, after about the second or third generation, suddenly those children become all in. Where's their parents? First generation was like they're all in, but you know, they were just peers. Your opinion, my opinion. Huh? The children become more respectful. If the parents modeled any kind of respect at all, they become more consecrated. Because now they're looking at someone who's a leader, not a peer. Leader. Now you're starting to get near to following Jesus. But many people can't see it after the spirit. They have to see it only after the human. They can only see it from a physical perspective. And so that natural perspective begins to link them to the spiritual. You begin to obey divine principles. I don't care where you're at. You obey divine principles, you can get hooked up with God's blessing. It takes usually second generation just to start doing what's right, to have that kind of honor. And then if that's repeated the second generation, third generation, it's explosive. Because you have the right spirit in the place. You got the right atmosphere. You've got honor to authority. Huh? Now you can have elders in the church. And it's not peers. You can't have elders in the church and it's peers. It won't work. Because it becomes a monster. Everybody wants to be the leader. It doesn't work. God didn't honor it. He won't honor it. Because people are just listening to things after the voice of the flesh, after the voice of the natural. They don't understand how to honor Papa. Papa said that God, though he wants to pour out all his glory, he can't. No, you guys you're just human. You're just human. You're doing it your own way. You don't want to do it my way. Then do whatever. I'll stand here and wait. I'll wait second generation. I'll wait third generation. If the church doesn't do it by the third generation, they're done. They're dead. They're done. They're done. It won't exist. It won't exist. And many times it as things are decided by the second generation. If there was not enough honor in this generation, there'd be no honor here. There'd be none. Many people, because they did not honor God, there was no honor here. No honor, no connection with the anointing, no connection with this body of Christ, no connection with heaven, no connection with Father, no connection with the Spirit. None. Does Father love you? He loves you. He loves the whole world. And the Holy Ghost broods over the chaos of the world. He's been poured out upon all flesh, moving upon God's people, saying, moving upon all the lost, saying, come on, do it my way, do it my way. Come and live. Come and live. Come, follow me. Come and live. A few people respond. Will you respond? Yes. When the Lord touched my life and I got filled with the Holy Ghost, all that happened to me is I realized there was more. When God touched me and I got filled with joy and laughter, all I realized was there's more. I just tasted. Huh? When God touched me and I was overwhelmed by peace and the glory of heaven, I just tasted. I realized there's so much more. This is just the beginning. I didn't feel like I'm in the fullness now. I was like, this is the beginning. Whew. This is the beginning that brings all the fullness. It is the fullness of him that filleth all things. It's the fullness. Now I got to grow in the fullness. And of his fullness have all we received. It's ours. Now we got to grow and mature in the fullness. It's been given to us. Now we get fully empowered, not limited. No one. It's a leveling floor. Everyone, your empowerment, your inheritance is everything, all of it, not partitioned out in portions based upon who you are and your genealogy. Everybody steps into it. Some of you go, whoa, this is amazing. I see the Lord. I'm so excited about what Ezekiel, man, I tell you right now, here, you know what I see? I see 10-year-old Ezekiel, 12-year-old Ezekiel, flowing the gift of spirit, flowing. Why? Because mom and dad's fasting and praying, crying out to God, oh God, raise up laborers for your harvest. Bring forth the seed, oh God, of those who know you and know how to walk with you. Do you know there's very few houses that hear that kind of prayer? There's very few houses that have that kind of prayer, that kind of desperation sounding out to the rooms of their house. There's very few Holy Ghost houses in the land today, says the Lord. Where would there be a change? Where would there be a remnant? Where would there be a people of the Lord who are not given over to the secular stuff, to the profane stuff? Where would there be a people that come all the way in? Quit trying to accommodate men and please men. Live for men. Start accommodating God, pleasing God, and living for God. Stand with me, will you? I don't have to ask you today if God has been dealing with your heart, because He has. Some of you, good response. Some of you, bad response. Some of you, oh, break me, God, change me, Lord, forgive me, Father, I want to get this right. Others, kind of a blank. No real passion has been stirred because the heart's been made hard. God wants to change that. He wants to give you a new heart, because you've been entangled again with the yoke of bondage. God will give you a new heart. He'll soften that heart. So many people's hearts have been trampled by bad experience. So many people's hearts have been trampled by offense, disappointment, discouragement. It's become wayside ground where the seed of the Word of God can't bring forth, just lays there on the surface. And Satan's not going to abide that for long. He'll come and swoop it up. Even though it's hard ground, that's just how rebellious he is. It's hard ground. Seed's never going to get in because it's hard ground. So, I mean, don't even take time. I mean, it's going to ruin on the surface. First rain, night, the ruin. But he won't even abide the word. He hates the word so much, he won't even abide its existence. Tonight, I want you to come back. I want you to come back to me. I'm going to talk about pure faith, the development of how to move in faith unfeigned, pure faith, where the stream is not polluted with anything, not those things that are blatant sinful and not those things that are of mammon. Because I'm going to tell you right now, more people's streams are polluted with mammon and with their own pride. If you don't understand, pride is an evil thing. It's just as evil as anything else. The pride of life is just as evil as anything else. It is the original evil. And it rules so many people's lives. And the only way that is truly confronted is because we give ourselves to learning to walk in meekness and lowliness and humility. And until you do, I tell you right now, when you can't come under authority in the church, you are being ruled by the pride of life on a higher scale than you can possibly imagine. Huh? You don't even qualify for giving yourself to learning humility and meekness and lowliness. You're not even started. You're not even begun. You're not even in the camp. You're not even in the house. You with me?
Yes.
Satan's tried to do everything he can possibly do to discredit this, but I'm telling you right now, the meek will inherit the earth. I'm telling you right now, God's word will not change. He said, come learn to be I'm meek and lowly. Come and understand this. Come learn how to be servant. Learn how not just to be a servant. Learn how to be a foot washing servant. This is the lowest servant of all. And you're not doing it to man anyways. We don't know anybody after the flesh. We know each man after the spirit. We understand the spiritual dimension of what God has set up in his house. Huh? Everybody wants to be special before God without making anybody else special. You want to be special before the Lord, then you make everybody else extra special. Then you get to begin. It is amazing to me the tricks that God's people allow Satan to play upon them. But I'm going to tell you right now, the Word of God exposes every one of them. I have found the safest place to be, living in the glory of God, is to give yourself continually to loving everyone and walking in humility. Most of every one of Satan's tricks will not work on you. You learn to love everybody in the first 3 seconds, no matter who they are. Cone head, thick head, pink head, doesn't matter. You give yourself to learning, loving everybody in the first 3 seconds. And you always walk in humility. It doesn't matter how anybody treats you. It doesn't really matter. It's not even important. I'm being treated especially great by the Lord. I'm like his favorite child. What everybody else does really doesn't have any real impact on me. It doesn't really matter what anybody thinks.
Amen.
It's matters what Papa thinks. Amen. But when it doesn't matter what Papa thinks, fully, then what everybody else thinks is a really big deal. Is that really what it was? Please tell me. You know, 10 seconds after you ask the first time, do you like me? And then 10 more seconds, do you still like me? And just living in insecurity, fear and torment and rejection and disappointment. And we got you the cure today, right now.
Yes.
And the Lord Jesus Christ, God's only begotten Son, will set you free. And when God's only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, sets you free, you shall be free indeed, absolutely free, now to learn how to walk in the freedom, live in the freedom of the Holy Spirit. Ha! For where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is this glorious freedom. Hallelujah. To walk free from sin, free from all the fear, free from all the torment. Somebody said, yes, I want to do that. Well, then you got to sign up to be servant. You got to sign up to tell me what to do now, Lord. What do I do now, Pastor? Oh, doesn't the Western society hate that? We want Trump. We want Trump. But we don't want anybody to tell us what to do in the church. We are messed up. You come to be a servant, you just not only say, Father, tell me what to do. You'll be, Pastor, tell me what to do. And believe me, I don't want you. You know, sometimes people call me Pastor, and I think they just said Pester. Because it is. It is a Pester. Because there was no sincerity to it. It wasn't real. It wasn't of the Spirit. It was just trying to accommodate a religious thing. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I'm not interested in having to tell everybody what to do. Believe me, I would not want such a job. Oh, now what do I do? What should I buy? Smooth peanut butter or crunchy? And you know what? It didn't just come to that. Reality of it is. I'm going to tell you what to do by the Spirit of the Lord. And if you don't have the heart and the submission to say, I want God to tell me what to do all the time. I want Pastor to tell me what to do all the time. Then when God lays it to you, you're not going to listen. You just think we're picking on you. Huh? You're going to think we're persecuting you. And all it does is reveal your heart. You're not submitted. You're not under authority. You don't want God to rule you. You've never come to be servant. You've never learned how to walk in humility. Meekness and loneliness are not a part of your life. Pride dominates you. The floodlight shines on the dynamics of the relationship reveal it. It's true. Because you walk in the kind of lowliness and meekness and love and submission that God gives you to do and that it allows us to have, those people the Lord's put over you in Him come tell you something that's totally off and you'll completely submit to it. And say, yes, I don't want that in my life. Oh, God, thank you so much. Pastor, change me, Father. There'll be no self-defense. You'll be a sheepy. Not a goat. You'll be a sheepy. Not a billy. Come on, people. Our lives. There's one thing you'll learn about this church. We give you practical applications of how to walk with God. And it's the dynamics of your decision and the dynamics of your responses and your attitudes. We're not going to give you some kind of esoteric. It's going to be very practical. Here's what your attitude, confronting what your decisions are, your behaviors, and bringing God and what He says right into it. Say, okay, no, Lord, I'm going to walk in love. I'm going to walk in brokenness and humility here. I'm going to submit myself into this situation. I don't understand it, but there's a lot of things I don't understand. Huh? That's wisdom. I don't understand it. When has that ever disqualified you? Right? Are you with me?
You're still flipping on the light. You're still making use of the blessing, even though you don't understand anything about it. Jesus is calling you, every one of you. You hear me. You hear the intent and the cry. God does not want you to live in sin and sorrow, in poverty and depression. He doesn't want you to live in everything that this world would impose upon you. He sent the deliverer, the Savior, to bring you out of that into a heavenly realm, to get you out of hell, your problem, your stuff. All Satan can do is destroy lives, destroy families, wreck bodies, eat out souls. Everything he touches is a plague and it's death. And God wants to deliver you from it and teach you how not to allow any of that stuff to come, not in that spiritual disease, to get anywhere near you. Huh? I tell you, I go to a restaurant, I go to a place to get something to eat, and they in there, and I see the box of gloves, and I see the bare hands, I say, hey, gloves. Put the gloves on. Huh? I'm gonna put my mouth in that slimy stuff. Come on. Dear people, it's about time you start making right choices about your spirit, what your spiritual diet is. It's about time you get yourself consecrated. You don't need all that stuff you've been getting fed anyways. Blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. But he delights in the Lord full time, all day long. That man shall prosper. That man shall be blessed. This is what God is saying. He is declaring these things for you and I so that we can be blessed. It's not for him, it's for you, us, that he declares this. Hallelujah. Because I'm going to tell you right now, he's going to be God with or without you. Hallelujah. He's going to live in forever with or without you. It's going to be good with or without you. It's going to be everything that it could possibly be ever be in life with or without you. He's just invited you to come enjoy it too. With or without you, God's good. With or without you, it's going to be glorious forever. But he's inviting you, come enjoy. And he's telling you what cannot come in and what cannot have that which he delights to give. He's going to show you what will destroy. Death will always destroy. Disobedience will always destroy it. Disobedience will end the garden experience, the paradise experience, the fellowship with God as quick today as it did with Adam. Just in the goodness of God's heart, in love and mercy, he's provided a way through the blood of Jesus Christ that if you're willing to repent and respond to Holy Ghost conviction, you can be restored. Religion has done this. It has condoned and it has permitted evil, wrong decisions, wrong lifestyles, wrong living. And people have been corrupted in the way. And are just as wrong as any immoral homosexual on the planet right now, and they're standing in the church with their hands lifted up going hallelujah. And they're just as wrong, because the pride of life and rebellion and arrogance and stubbornness is just as wicked to Papa as homosexuality and everything else in the categories of evil. And some of you will not see until you fall down upon your knees and begin to get right with God and begin to fast and pray and begin to say, I'm putting your church first, morning, evening. I'm putting your church first. I'm going to be in the meeting to start with. I'm going to learn how to come under authority. Because then in that practical application, you're going to see all the stuff where your heart's really at. What you're willing to do and what you're not willing to do. Come on, people. It's time to start living for God. Now that you've received this new life in God, it's time to start living for God. Now that you've been born of the Spirit, it's time for you to start living by the Spirit. Now that you've received the Holy Ghost, it's now time for you to be ruled by the Holy Ghost.
Not ruled by circumstances and decisions and what profits you and what better for you and what you agree with and disagree with. Every blessing in God that I've entered into, I entered into not because I had some revelation, I just simply obeyed. I just obeyed God's word. I put Him first. I put His stuff first. And I said, Father, I'm going to do what You said to do. With all of my fallibility, with all my lack of real true understanding of it, I just obeyed God with what I understood, with the simplicity of what God said. And then all He did is He just made it bigger, more clear, more understandable, and it got better, and hallelujah. And we're just beginning, because I'm going to tell you right now, Father is about to take our lives and shake the world. Ann and I are getting ready in the Spirit of the Lord to shake the United States of America. Not only has this been made real to us, it's been witnessed by many prophets in the past, and even in the past for a couple of days, we know for a certainty what God will do with our life. It doesn't matter our experience. It doesn't matter the hardships. It doesn't matter all the things we've had to go through. It doesn't matter all the persecution. It doesn't matter all the belittlements. It doesn't matter all the things that men will try to do, Satan will try to do. God's word stands. A day is the same as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day. Hallelujah. What God said 30 years ago was a couple of seconds. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Is as it were a couple of seconds. It's not as it is. It is as it were. Today, you decide, will you let God take your life and do wonderful things with it? It's more than just a one-time altar call. When you come up to the altar, that's what this is. It's an altar. You are throwing yourself upon the altar to now live on the altar. Father, there in that place, will do some wonderful. You can't get a better life. You can't find a better way. It's heaven now and heaven forever. It's God communing with you. You can't find a better friend, not a better community, not a better group. No, sir. He's inviting you. He pleads with you. He begs you. He petitions you. He says, come on in. You've got to leave all your stuff behind. It can't come with you. Just you. Naked you came into this world. Naked you shall go out. God's interested in what's going on in your heart and your soul and your body and your spirit and your very being. Not all your stuff, not all your ideas. It's got to stay outside. It cannot come in with you. Not your discouragement, not disappointment, not all your offenses, not all your problems, not all your issues. God's inviting you, a brand new you, a change, a complete and total renovation of your life with the fire of God. A new earth to exist in, a new heaven to interact with. What will you do? What will you do? What will you do? Today, we pray that you'll decide. Forget about all the complications. Forget about all the logistics. Forget about all the issues. Forget about all the challenges. Just dive in. Just step in. Just say, I'm going with you. I am with total abandonment. You're not leaving me out. With total abandonment, I'm not going to be left out. I'm laying hold on the refuge. I tell you right now, you listen to me. Listen to me. If I would have been in the camp and I saw Jesus take Peter, James, and John, and they go somewhere, I guarantee you, I'm going to. I don't know what's wrong with the rest of those guys laying around. I would have slept with one eye open. Now what's happening? I'd have had a hold of his leg and you'd have to be dragging me the whole way. I'm going. I'm not going to be left out. You don't be. Come on now. What is it that's so good in your life that you're not willing to let go of it to have Jesus? What wonderful thing is it that you're doing right now that you're not willing to walk away from it to walk into His glory and majesty and live His life? What is it? What hinders you from throwing your whole life at this very moment, not later, not next year, now, upon the altar of sacrifice, to live fully for the living God. What's in your way? Nothing but deceptions and lies and shadows. God's calling you. Come on in. Every person standing in this place right now, everybody watching me by the web right now or by YouTube, God is calling you right now, right where you stand, right where you sit, right where you're listening. He's calling you to step into a realm of glory that He's made available to anybody, anywhere, at any time, by the confession of your mouth, by the willingness to consecrate your heart, to step into a place of walking for it with Him, living for Him, and then let Him work it out and faithfully do what God has given you to do, and don't bend nor bow to every distraction. Or any distraction. What will you do? What will you do? In Jesus' name, you decide today. God is calling you. You decide today. He's calling you. You let this be an altar call right where you're at right now. You sanctify that as an altar. Your heart, your life. That you walk out of here with the altar, that you live at the altar, you live on the altar. You sanctify it right where you at, that from this day forward, it's not just a place up front in the meeting. It's your communion with God. It's your fellowship with God. It's your relationship with God. It's your interaction with God. It's your worship with God. It's your place of prayer. It's your place of praise. It's your place of obedience. You decide today. You decide today. And don't turn away, don't back up, because I'm telling you right, oh, heaven is mobilized for you. Don't you doubt for one minute. God is on your side, and if God be with you, who can stand against you? If God be for you, there is nothing that can turn you away unless you will it. I want every person in this place, I want you to take your life and present it to Jesus Christ so that His life can live, be lived through you. I want you to take your job and say, Lord, it's just something to reveal, for you to be revealed, your glory to be revealed through me. It's not going to be a distraction. It's not going to be something that preoccupies my life. I want it to burn with the fire of the Holy Ghost. I want there to be a mighty rushing wind. I want there to be fruit that abounds unto you. You begin to talk to God. Begin to talk to God in this place. Begin to lift up your voice and talk to God. You begin to tell Him from your heart the life that you surrendered to Him, that you're not going to take it back. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. I break the power of every mind-blinding spirit in the name of Jesus Christ. I deliver you from it. If there's anybody here today, you want us to pray with you and for you because you're not sure if you're right with God, or you're not sure that that your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, or perhaps you've never called upon the name of Jesus Christ. You just thought because you were baptized when you were a baby and born into religion that you're right with God. No, it's an encounter that God wants to have with you where He meets with you at the place of your heart and affections. If you've never had that meeting, if you've never had that encounter, if there's anybody in this place, I want you to understand me very clearly. If there's anybody in this place, you don't know if you have a new heart and a new spirit. You don't know if you've been born again. You don't know if you're right with God. You're uncertain. I want you to come right now because Father wants to give you certainty. I don't want anybody leaving this place without absolute certainty. Come right now. The Lord will touch you. He'll change you. Everybody in this place. You know your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. You're right with God. If you were to die right now, you would absolutely find yourself hearing Him say, well done, my good and faithful servant. And not only if you were to die right now, but in that you live right now, you're going to live unto Him and for Him. That's what you're saying. Father, we thank You for such love. Now, Father, there's a whole company of people standing in this place that have said that they've given their life completely over to You. Father, I know that it doesn't take this many to reach the whole of the nation. It doesn't even take this many. So, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus, there will not only be those who have begun with you, but there will be those who will follow you and be perfected by you and mature and grow in you, God, that your way, that everything that you've provided becomes fully developed in their lives. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hey, if you're right with God and fully living for him, just go ahead and lift up your voices and shout, thank you, Lord Jesus. People, we come to the meeting because it's at the meeting where we learn, where we're instructed in the way, where the divine gifts of the Spirit, the working of the power of God is imparted into life and developed in our lives. Make sure that you put church first in Jesus' mighty name. We want you to come also today. We want you to worship the Lord with your tithes and offerings. We want you to understand this is the only way that you can take of that which God has given to you and put it into the realms of heaven. Are you listening to me? Yeah. It's not a financial exchange of one goods for another. This is where you take and transfer those things that belong to you into a realm called the heavenly. And understand, it's not like it's, you know, in another. It's the heavenly realm. It's like not on another planet. It's a heavenly realm. In other words, it goes to work for you now to produce heaven now. Now. Are you listening? The riches of God's glory doing something now. Hallelujah. A miracle happening now.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Now, I pray many of you today that you'll go home from here, from this place, and that you'll get into a place of prayer and seeking God.
Yes.
So that you'll be spiritually prepared to be able to worship with us.
Yes.
Tonight.
Yes.
Amen.
Because
we're not going to take no little, you know, kumbaya. It's going to be in the Masoreta by the Spirit of God. It's going to be the human ability kind of worship. We want you to pray. Seek God so you come interact with what God the Holy Ghost is doing. And also be able then in that same place be able to receive what Father wants to impart by His Word and by His Spirit so that you begin to walk in a greater display of the gift of faith.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
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 These things are available. Hallelujah. It's something that we don't earn, we just receive, but we've got to participate with God in order to receive them. Understand that. You think, well, I can just sit around and do whatever I'm doing. I can sit here and watch, you know, television, do whatever I'm doing, I'm going to receive this. You're not. You have to participate with God to receive it. It's not earned, but you must participate with God to receive it. I'm going to say it again. It's not earned, but you must participate with the Spirit of God to receive it. God does not receive any praise unless it's by the Holy Ghost. If it's not by the Holy Ghost, by the Spirit, it's not truth. If you don't, so we're here to teach you how to let the Holy Ghost flow through you. We do on Friday nights, we do what we call a school of the Spirit. There are Bible schools right now using the School of the Spirit series. I know preachers who have taken the School of the Spirit series, especially one preacher, and has actually written them all out. What and this person, God has used in great signs and wonders throughout the world. Look, and you know what that is? It is just a description of how they got into the anointing that they functioned in all their life anyways. That's just the level of seriousness. I'd just be happy if God's people would just listen to it one time through. I mean, I haven't mandated you should scribe it out. But if you want to grab a hold of how to flow in the Holy Ghost, you're gonna get these things. You're going to start acting like, you know, the one that is given to you is just your peer. Because the one who's given it to you is the Holy Ghost. It's like, you know, people act like, oh, I know that. You don't know. If you knew it, you'd do it. And even people who know it, and, you know, who are doing it. Still, anybody who's doing it, that means the hunger is even greater. So I want that stuff to change in your life. The things that have deceived you, the things that have run interference in your mind and have kept you from seeking God, you stop it by doing what's right. Don't continue on doing what you've been doing. You stop it by imitating those who walk in humility and brokenness, who are seeking God, who are not acting like they know it all, but want to receive it all. Huh? Don't be a know-it-all. Be a receive-it-all.
Yes.
Amen? Be a, say, I'm a receive more.
I'm a receive more.
I belong to the family of the receive mores.
I belong to the family of
the and those who passionately pursue.
Those who passionately pursue.
Amen. Come worship the Lord with your tithes, with your offerings. If there's anybody in here who's sick or diseased in their body, or you want us to pray about anything in your life, we're here to pray with you and for you. Everybody listen to me. Keep in prayer highest on your prayer list. Right now we're finishing up the church. I want you to move in faith. I don't feel a lot of faith here right now. I want you to move in faith. Listen, I want you to do it in faith. I don't want you to do it out of half to. Do it in faith. Do it in faith. We're finishing up the building of the church right now in Oregon. And we just want every one of you to step over into the realms. Listen to me. Understand what I'm saying. God wants you to step into a realm of faith where you can finance things, not something that you're doing. Because we're not relying on you. People, I want you to understand. I want you to understand me. We are not relying on you to give. We are relying on you to step over to a realm of faith to hear God and have supernatural provision. That's what we're preaching. That's what we're relying on. Are you listening to me? Somebody said, oh, there's just one, some of us, our finances and money. It's just too big of a sacrifice. I don't know how we're going to do it. We don't even want that. That's like a lame offering with one blind eye and wasn't born with a leg, stands on three legs, got a blind eye and a swollen face. We don't even want that offering. Are you listening to me? Amen. Praise God. The babes want to get to dancing and praising and praying, and I'm with them. I'm totally with them. Do you hear me? Do you hear what I'm saying? Because God wants you to hear right. It's so easy to hear wrong. If you're living wrong, you're going to hear wrong. To hear right, you got to live right. To live right, you got to pursue those things which God has said that you and I are to do. If we're not pursuing it, we'll never have it. One amen. A couple of grumbles. Three, help me God. Come on, people. No, say yes, Lord. You know what I'm going to do in school spirit? I'm going to have speech. How to talk. Learning how to speak. And it's not going to be 101 because that's like college level. This is going to be learning how to speak. You got to say something. You got to speak to the mountain. You got to say it. You got to confess it. You got to proclaim it. You got to say it's true. It's so. It's mine. I want it. Amen. Doesn't do it. The Lord has said, clap your hands. Everyone who claps their hands will be saved. He said, everyone who confesses, speak it. Come on, people. That's what we're going to do. School of Spirit. Learning how to talk. Learn how to speak. Speak it out. Say, yes, I want that. That's me.
Yes, I want that.
See, I need to be the preacher and I need to be one of the people that's in the meeting. Because if you're around me in a meeting, I'm like going, yeah, that's me. I'll interact with what the message. That's me. I'm doing that. Yes. Thank you, Father. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. But it's real. It's not just some kind of, cheerleading section. Right. Amen.
Amen.
It's an anointing of God. Otherwise, it's a distraction. Would you please be quiet? We're trying to hear what he's saying. But when it's reacting, it's in you. Yes. I'm speaking to the mountain. I'm living that life. I'm pursuing that thing. I'm not going to go home, sit on the couch, and act like I'm seeking first the kingdom. Huh? Reinhard Bonnke said, there's one thing God can't do. Only one thing in all the world and the universe that God cannot do. Only one. People are looking at him going, huh? Get you off the couch. You have to stand up of your own free will and respond to God and go. Amen. Praise the Lord. Whew. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Come on, man. You gotta come. You gotta grab a hold of it. You gotta grab a hold of it. Say it's mine. I'm gonna do it.
It's mine. I'm gonna do it.
Thank you, mighty God. Get happy about these things.
Yes.
Now God knows whether it's mine. I'm gonna do it, and whether it's like 15th on your schedule of priorities. Huh? Come on, people. Get passionate in Jesus' name. Find a bunch of people around you, hug them, tell them that you love them, bless them in Jesus' name. I'm going to labor to break you through later. We'll take this back up later.